done by the USDA about herbicides, and it goes into the active ingredients of Roundup.
Yeah, so there's.
Is there a nicotinoid?
Nicocarinoid?
Because we already have that.
Cross Street, there's just this.
That's what these are?
That's this one.
I didn't have anything for Arcadia Avenue.
Goes into, so, paraquat, MAA, MSMA, these are the chemicals, so,
This is what I was looking for.
Interesting.
I didn't see that.
I can, hold on a sec, I might actually have an electronic copy. How are you, Amy?
Good, how you doing?
Yeah. Like to call the Conservation Commission meeting to order, please. And the first item on the agenda is a request for determination of applicability, 2016-790, Rustic Lane, map 46, lot 82, Doherty. Is there a representative?
Hi, for the record, I'm Jack Sullivan, owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group, and I'm here with the owner, John Doherty. And basically, he's looking to construct a 22-by-24 addition off the rear of his house. I just need to clarify one thing. In speaking with John originally, he told me it was gonna be a full foundation. He meant it was gonna be a slab on grade. We just had this conversation, which is good because there's a high groundwater table. His existing house has a slab on grade. So this will be a standard frost wall construction slab on grade. There's an existing roof porch to the rear that will be removed as part of this project. There's no site grading changes, and there'll be a 2 foot wide by 12 inch deep peach stone drip trench along the edge of the roof line to provide some method of roof water recharge for this project. We also show a proposed soil stockpile area over here, and the construction entrance for this project will be over the existing paved driveway. The wetlands were flagged by Norse Environmental. They run right along the rear of the property line. And we have 75 feet from the wetland line to the limit of work line. So it's pretty straightforward. No trees to be cut, very little grading changes, basically taking out an existing structure and replacing with a larger structure in the same area. We show erosion control, stake hay bales with silt fencing along the limit of work line. I'll turn it over to the commission if there's any questions.
Okay, wait a minute, Jamie, can you hold it?
I can.
Thank you. There was a question in the last meeting from Mr. Curtis about some soggy areas in the back along the stone wall, this side of the wetland flag. So on Sunday we took a second inspection and did a few augers out there. In the area directly back from the right in the middle, we didn't find any evidence of redoxymorphological features. There was an area down on the left-hand side, and there's a depression, and there's a bit of standing water and a few maybe sensitive fern in there, but there was a high point between that and the delineated line, and it wouldn't have, in our estimation, exceeded the 500 square foot for isolated wetland under the Reading bylaw. Do you have anything to add to that?
Nope.
Jamie, do you have some more questions?
Well, I was going to bring that up, but I was also going to just ask the question. We made that site visit 2.5 weeks ago. Was this not on the agenda at our last meeting?
I asked for a continuation.
There was a continuation.
Oh, here.
Right.
John was traveling. And
okay.
I had a conflict with two other meetings, so without him being available, without me being available, I asked Chuck to continue.
Okay. I just was wondering if my memory was slipping badly. So this potentially isolated wetland in the south corner of the lot, it is not contingent with that wetland?
No, there was sort of a, it's a low point, and then it rises up probably a good 18 inches, would you say?
Yeah.
Around the area of the stone wall and just behind it, and then it goes back down towards, the wetland.
Any other questions from the commission members? Chuck, do you have?
Well, can I just ask a quick question? Is the property line, is the stone wall?
Yes.
Okay.
Any comments or questions from the public? And if so, please identify yourself in your address. Okay. Hearing none.
I move we issue a negative determination for 90 Rusty Glen.
Second.
RDA.
All those in favor? Are you in favor?
Sorry, I keep doing that.
Are you abstaining?
Yes.
Okay. I wasn't looking at me away, so sorry. All right.
So I have that prepared if you would like to sign it.
Yes. We're 4 minutes ahead of schedule. Is there anything we could do quickly?
I have something quick. We had town meeting Monday night, night before last, and there was an article before town meeting to change the dog laws. And one of the issues was that under the proposal, the dogs could run free in conservation land. And we were able to change that so that dogs can run free on conservation land only if it's in compliance with Conservation Commission rules for conservation land. So we regained control over our conservation lands. And what prompted the issue was probably primarily Bear Meadow, which used to have a very healthy woodcock population, and that woodcocks are small galvanaceous or gram bird that have their nest on the ground. And we think possible contributor to the decline of the population is the nest being disturbed or breeding activities being disturbed. And if a dog is running free, he could disturb a nest, they could abandon the nest. So we don't know for sure that's the cause, but we just wanted to retain the authority. And we explained at town meeting that the rules for conservation land are the authority of the Conservation Commission. However, they're not promulgated in a vacuum. They're promulgated after notice and public meeting and discussion, and then promulgated. So pending meeting members seem comfortable with that. So at some point, if we want to look into that and do anything about it, we have that option.
So, Jamie, I'm a little confused. There.
Well, we talked about the dog laws for 3 hours on Monday night.
Yeah.
You want me to repeat the entire conversation?
No, I don't. Okay. I appreciate the abridged version. I guess, so it's going to be under the Conservation's Commission's rules, but what are the Conservation Commission rules?
Right now, and I need to be, I tried to check the web page, and Chuck, we need to check this. I could not find the rules for conservation land on the web page. They were on the old web page, but they don't seem to be on the new web page, or if they are, they're masqueraded. But my memory is that we allow dogs on conservation land as long as they're on a lease or under voice control of the owner or the keeper, and they have to pick up their fecal matter.
Mm-hmm.
And that's universal, as far as I remember, on all conservation lands. But we do have certain rules for different lands. For example, we allow hunting on some lands and not on others. So we could take an area of Bear Meadow and have it the restriction just for that area and just during breeding season. So we have that latitude. Did I waste enough time?
No, no. You need to sign, please. Got another minute.
tell you that dogs in the cemetery for a long time.
How about the town forest? Oh, man. Took my bike in there.
In the cemetery?
No, the town forest. There's a lady, there are three ladies that were $57, and two of them were wolfhounds, Irish wolfhounds. Okay, being at 7:10, we will start the continued notice of intent hearing for 56 Cross Street. The public hearing, DEP 270-0659, is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports from the administrator. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. Anybody wishing to speak, or anybody, I would suggest that are in attendance, please sign in the sign-in sheet in the back. At this time, would the members of the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, starting on my left.
Chuck Troney, Conservation Administrator.
Gary Curtis.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Jamie Mullen.
Al Couillard.
Okay. And who's here?
Am I going crazy again? Didn't win this on the agenda for last week?
Yes, it was.
It was.
And it was continued?
Yes.
So even though I missed the meeting, I didn't miss that much.
All right. It was great, though. It was a great meeting last meeting.
Jamie, we wouldn't want you to miss anything.
Really? Is there anyone here for 56 Cross Street?
Yes, we're Harry and Sean Armstrong, owners. So we are back from last week, as you know, when we were discussing the infiltration at the proposed addition, and we've supplied to Chuck a revised plan that addresses the driveway runoff with the trench, which was something that came up
So we didn't get that cross section, or in our
package? We got it late this afternoon.
Okay.
And there was a little misunderstanding with what we were asking for, and we were actually sent some material that we already had. And then when Steve got back in the office, he was able to get this. This is stamped.
Okay.
So I do believe this is what we're waiting for. In the back, where they have the trench just beyond the deck, they're going to put wrap it in the fiber material, and they're going to put topsoil on top of it, 6 inches of loam. So.
Okay.
Who prepared that drawing? Can you scroll that?
Ronald Close.
Is he a surveyor or
civil
engineer?
Engineer.
That's a PE license. Mm.
Another question. It seemed to me on the original plans we showed riverfront. Did we get that corrected?
We didn't get into it.
We didn't change it.
And we didn't make a determination. We left it. This is, we just left it.
The stream showed up on the USGS map, and that was the reason that Steve Erickson called it riverfront.
I recall the property on the other side of that stream, and I don't think we called it riverfront at that time. I don't think that is riverfront.
That was kind of the gist of the discussion as well.
So nobody has made the determination or revisited the issue. Nobody's done the calculations.
No.
We should do that. Maybe you've already been over this. I hate to beat old ground, but if that is in fact riverfront, which I don't believe it is, this addition would be in the roof.
It was my sense at the last meeting that the Conservation Commission basically agreed that it wasn't riverfront.
On
based
what
on
basis? I
based
don't.
Based on the previous filing on the other side.
Okay, so we checked the other filing.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. All right.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. So the had the plans been changed or they should
we
be
just
changed.
Haven't we just didn't ask them to modify the plans. We just thought we'd get to the design, I think, was more the...
Right, and the change, I guess, from last meeting was there were two Coltec
correct.
Chambers, and I guess, Anika, you said you didn't...
You wanted the specs on them, all the Coltecs.
Yeah, I believe the end of the last meeting, and my memory's a little fresher because I actually listened to the retaping of it. was that at the end of last meeting it sounded like there was going to be maybe a Coltec chamber in the back of the yard and some trench next to the driveway, and we were looking for the design plans for that, and instead of Coltec it looks like based on these plans that you're going with two trench drains. So one by the side of the driveway and one in the back of the yard.
Right. And if the
to cover.
Commission would rather have the Coltex, we're fine with that.
Let's see if I get the right one.
So my recollection, Anika, was that...
You had suggested
we,
that, Al.
We had... There was a discussion about how functional the Coltex were going to be because of how shallow groundwater is. And we asked for a design from Steve Erickson. And his opinion at the time and was that the Coltec probably wasn't going to be that functional, but he had included it because he
right.
figured we needed it.
Right. Right.
It looks like now we've been submitted a design and he's included a trench drain in the location that we've asked with the calculations, but has eliminated the Coltec, presumably because it wasn't necessary and probably wasn't doing it.
But we have the design anyway.
Yes.
I guess my question to you, Mike, is at the time you had asked for an operations and maintenance plan.
Well, it's the Coltec. We don't have a Coltec anymore.
So we don't need anything for the infiltration?
No.
No.
Okay.
Operation and maintenance.
Well, it's not a
watch it.
Trench drain.
It's a trench drain.
So leaves might be an issue.
No. So detail that I just saw is that it's a filter. Wrapped with the filter fabric. It's really just for infiltration. It's like a French drain. They've got protection around it so it doesn't get silted in. It's not a...
Right, and it's probably, I guess, part of this is coming from, I think is coming from the gutters. Right, from the roof.
Yeah.
Right,
well,
so
the driveway, so.
Yeah.
But is it actually connected directly to the...
Yes, that's the, is that an 8-inch pipe? That's
it
what he's showing.
Yeah. Yeah.
That'll elbow up and connect right into the downspout.
Mm. I mean, I guess there's potential for leaves to get into the gutters. They go into there. Usually there's some sort of relief. I don't know if that's a point.
But once it hits the drain with the fabric over it, it wouldn't.
Well, so
the fabric
is for infiltration,
right?
From ground, you know, surface flow. That's what the fabric's protecting. This is, from what I'm hearing, is connected directly to the drain. So if water, the roof drain. So if
right.
water comes down the spout, there's leaves in there,
it'll get
and it's
blocked up down the bolt.
Correct.
It'll start clogging up the drain pipe. That's off.
Which you'll notice because the gutters will back up.
You won't enjoy that. So I don't know what the typical engineering... I know this problem is dealt with in other systems like this. It's just... I just can't remember exactly what they do to fix that problem. I know there is a fix to that.
Well, so the easiest solution... A lot of times what you see is like an extra sleeve or an extra valve. A washout, basically, for them
like
to
clean out.
Clean out, exactly.
Clean out, like, at the top, where you can
Exactly. Just provides a second access. You know, the other, the less convenient way is you just end up disconnecting it and you have to clean it out that way.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have hooded gutters? Or is there a cover over the gutter?
As of right now, no.
I think it's more of a best practice rather than a, but it's not a requirement. Yeah, it's not an operation type thing.
Where's the closest tree?
Yeah.
Front and to the left of the house. They're
so
not directly over
the house.
There's
nothing directly over the house. There's a pine tree on our neighbor's property on the right hand side, and then we do have two trees on the left hand side, but nothing is over the house. And
mm-hmm.
I don't think those would
okay.
cause any
right.
issue.
There,
on that
there used
side
to be trees, but
it,
he got a permit to take them.
Yeah, there was
year.
A couple.
Do you usually have a big massive pile of leaves in your gutters, or is it?
We own the house.
Oh, okay.
Okay, house,
gotcha.
So we really don't know. Actually, well, we were there in September, so this fall we didn't really get anything.
Not too bad.
Yeah, and we didn't take the trees down until like November. So we didn't really have any blockages or anything like that.
So if you're going to clean your gutters once a year, you can get a little insert for the top right at the
like
gutter.
Like a screen.
Yeah, and then you don't
yeah,
have to worry about it getting down into the infiltration chambers.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of options.
Yeah, I mean, that,
yeah,
I think that's just a best practice type way. There's many ways to go about it. There's plenty of solutions for you, but I don't think that's necessarily a requirement I see.
But Mike, I think you hit the nail on the head. If this thing clogs up, the downspout will back up, and the gutters will back up, and water will be coming into the house.
Yes,
yeah,
you're going to know it.
And you're not going to want to clean out that pipe. The infiltration pipe
right.
in the ground. This, you know, so I just bring it up to advise you,
right. yep.
you know, how to operate the system and to ensure longevity. Yeah.
Any other comments, questions from the commission? Any comments, questions from the public?
The only thing I would say, the plan doesn't say anything about the gutters being connected to the trench. I think it would probably be.
Is there a line?
I think that's
something?
What these are. I think that's.
Is that what those are?
Yeah.
Oh, I see it. Okay.
That's what this.
All right.
This connection.
Okay.
This connection.
Right.
And this connection is.
Where do you see that?
A little teeny line between the trench and the corner of the house.
Yeah.
What are the other teeny lines?
Oh, I see.
I mean, that can just be added to the note, to the order.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Just to make sure it's clear.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
Before we do, I think it's important that we get this riverfront off the drawing. If it's not riverfront, it shouldn't be on the drawing.
For a notice of intent, they're required to provide an as-built, right?
Right.
Yes.
Right. So we could ask for it at that point.
Ask for it at that point.
I mean, it could be one of the findings in the order.
I would prefer to have it off the drawing because neighbor
right.
could go in the file and see that that's riverfront, and we approved this plan, and we're on record as saying it's riverfront.
We're on record saying that it's not.
Well, I would just feel better if it wasn't on the plan. Because the plan's attached to the order of conditions.
So that's just, we can get a new plan. We
get
can get
a plan
revised plan.
Why do that? If you don't want to pay the engineer to redo it, I'd be
yeah.
fine with that. Why did I even read it?
Well, it's just...
if somebody stamped it, you shouldn't do that, but...
Yeah, it's just a little unclear if we're stopping the whole train or if we're just going to get that plan next week and we can sign the order.
We can get it next week, but the one that's filed with the order of conditions,
yep. okay.
I'll be much more comfortable if the word riverfront were not on it.
Okay.
All right.
I can make that call tomorrow.
All right.
Ask for that.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Who's the engineer?
It's not Sean.
It's
no, the engineer.
There's a surveyor.
Edward Farrow.
Oh.
Are they gonna be comfortable taking it off, knowing it's on the USGS as a river?
Yeah, they're gonna be delighted.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Because it's less restrictive.
And I think it was probably Steve Erickson's call.
Yeah, I think it was.
And not
okay,
the surveyor.
All right, I just don't want you to come back to us in 2 weeks and say they wouldn't change it.
We can
okay.
still have it in the order of conditions
okay.
and tax the order of conditions so that
okay.
the
all
right. onus is on us.
Okay. Thank you.
So I move we issue a order of condition for 56 Cross Street in conformance with the revised plan and the application submitted.
I'll second.
What, Chuck?
Oh, I was just going to make a comment to the applicant that when I did write this, I have in there that you're going to contact me and we're going to go through that edge and as part of some mitigation that you offered, remove the invasives.
Yeah, we already actually, I know you had asked to clean out, I have a picture if you'd like to see. We already started to clean out the debris, and if you'd like, I can show you.
Sure.
Yeah, great.
We found, yeah, some.
Some interesting things?
Yeah.
A few things.
Yeah. So this is everything that we have taken so far.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Well, thank you for doing that.
That was just the stuff that
yeah, we saw it in there.
So that we could.
So, you guys want to see this?
Holy cow.
It's
yours. You threw it there.
Nice weekend chore.
Yeah, you wasn't too happy, but I did lose
pretty strong
yeah.
form.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are you abstaining?
No.
Oh, you voted for.
So I wrote the order of conditions. Wouldn't take too long to look at it. There is one change, which is perennial to intermittent, but I can make that change.
Great.
Okay.
We still need a motion. Do we still need a motion to close the hearing?
We do, but we usually
do it after the order of conditions?
Yeah, if the order of conditions is going to be issued next week.
Yeah.
Sometimes waiting to close the hearing until it's issued.
We could do that.
Are you, when is your anticipated construction schedule?
We have to close the variance, so.
Oh, okay. You've got,
you know.
Yeah.
Why don't you send it out and we can make those changes, send it in, and sign it next week, and close the hearing next week.
Or in 2 weeks.
Or in 2 weeks.
So will we have to come back?
You can certainly, you're welcome to, but I don't think there's.
You may want to take a look at the order of conditions.
Yeah, we'll send it to you. If you have any questions, you can come and ask.
Okay.
That's it. Thank you.
All right. And the next item on the agenda, 720 NRAD 270-0658 Low Meadow, off of Arcadia Avenue, map 14, lot 15, Pasco. And this was to review the new flags for riverfront area. Chuck, did you have an opportunity?
Yes, we had a site walk last night at this Low Meadow and checked out the flags for the riverfront. And I gave Steve a call because they all seem to be right on pretty much the edge of the bank. The bank wasn't that high where they were, so it definitely wasn't, it was bank full, but it wasn't probably mean annual high water where they were. And so then I call Steve, and he believes they're in the right spot. And I highlighted some stuff right here for you guys to read and to look at. And this is actually also came in today at the last minute, so I brought it to the meeting. But what we're looking for is, it seems to meet the definition of a meandering stream. And I think we would all agree that, to that. And then at bankful conditions, you're only supposed to look for a change in vegetation. So from herbaceous to woody, and that's right out of the regs. So Steve is saying that he believes that those flags for the riverfront is in the correct spot, but if the commission would like to make the changes that I said we were talking about on 4, 5, and mostly 4 and 5.
4, 5, and 6.
He's okay with it.
So, for riverfront, the 200 feet extends not from bank, but from some line. It has to do with high water line of the
right.
river?
Annual high water line
of a river?
That's what the discussion was about, and it's because it's a slow stream, meandering stream, and there's some other criteria that it has to meet, and it seemed to meet all that criteria, so then we're looking at, so oxbows, histostalls, slow flow channel, low gradient. This is his, you know, his reply to why the flags were so close to the bank.
So there were also RF2 and RF1 weren't located?
Right. His explanation was that they were there, but that riverfront is actually on the neighboring property that has all the leaves in that area.
So was RF1 jetting in because of the leaves?
It was jetting out.
Jetting into the river.
Right.
I guess I
into
would say.
The river.
Okay, so Chuck, just to be clear, you're I'm sorry, I'm getting a little lost in definitions here. Observing the site, it was pretty clear to me that it was very, very difficult to find a single clear defined channel. I mean, there were definitely places where the water was flowing, but you know, I can agree that this is a lower flow, meandering, poorly defined bank river system right now. So based on that, how does that impact the flags on the plan? So the flags on the plan were based.
So the easiest way to explain it is it's that change in vegetation on just beyond the bank that you're supposed to look for.
And that's the beginning of the 200 feet.
That's the beginning of the 200
right.
feet.
So in other words, the edge of the water when it starts hitting.
Beyond the edge of the water.
When it starts hitting maybe a slightly upland wetland plant.
Can I
is
ask?
Because that's what I saw.
A slightly upland? No, they would all be, we're not looking for upland plants. It could be any plant, but a change in types.
Environment.
Like woody, you know. To, I don't know, what else would be there? Like skunk cabbage to some sort of woody plant.
Shrub
yeah.
or?
Shrub.
If you think about the Ipswich River, west of Mill Street, for example, there's probably 100 or 200 feet of bordering vegetative wetlands
right.
outside of the river channel.
Right.
So.
Right.
The boring vegetated wetlands, in theory, could extend beyond the 200 feet of riverfront? I don't think that's correct.
Yes.
It could?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, why not?
Sure, why not?
If you've got a low area and you've got a defined channel in there, like think of the Connecticut River. I mean, that would be some low spots along the Connecticut, you know? Yeah. Chuck, when I'm reading this, bankful field indicators include but are not limited to.
Mm-hmm.
Can it be just one of those? Does it? You've got
changes in vegetation is underlined, but there's changes in slope, changes in vegetation, stain lines, top of point bars, changes in bank material or bank undercut.
Well, he's you know, hanging his hat on the at least two of those criteria, and he's found two that matches site.
And why did you consider it further towards Arcadia Avenue? What
because right around, well, the area at, so RF 4, 5, and
6 yeah.
seem to be further out than the, you know, the buffer zone or the bordering vegetated wetland. So, and between 6, 5, and 6, that only comes up above where the river channel is by about 2 or 3 inches. And then at flag 8A, it breaks steeply up the slope. So on a good rainstorm or on any rainstorm, it looks like that would be washed over. So for me, the bank was further back. That's why we started moving things.
So the RF 5 would be closer to 8A than as depicted on this plan, is what
right.
you're saying, because of the steepness of the... It's really, really flat, and your feeling is that it would, during mean annual high,
it would be
go
over
a little
that,
bit further up.
It would be over that bank.
So if the applicant doesn't have an issue with relocating those flags, then why don't we just have him do it?
Do you know if
yeah.
Steve Erickson has an issue with this?
He wanted us to go through this exercise, but he said at the end, if you still felt like you need to move the flags, that he's okay with it.
How far are you talking about moving them?
RF5 was going 7 feet. It was going right up to 8A.
That was the maximum.
That was
no
the maximum. And then
no
the rest of them are moving. They're pretty much moving to the BVW line.
Just inside the BVW sure. line is
yeah.
basically what it was.
Yep, I have no problem with that.
Is there any issue with RF1 or RF2?
Yeah, so we were out there yesterday, and so we say property line. We don't actually show that as a property line here. Because it seemed like I was under the same impression when I was out there that was near the property, but yeah, I mean, that's...
Well, we were over by flag 1 looking for RF, RF 2.
You're right, huh?
Yeah, it was started at 3.
Okay.
Oh, you couldn't find 2?
No.
You found
so,
1?
So is RF 1 the one that's on the other side of the water there?
That must be, yeah.
Well, so I don't agree with that.
What? You mean the stream channel is in between RF 1 and RF 2?
Yeah.
Well, that can't be right.
We didn't cross the water.
We didn't
to
go across
check.
The water to go check the tag, but.
Well, how could it be
we
on
did.
The other side?
Was that?
Yeah, I wasn't sure. I mean, the flags were, roughed up. Is
yeah.
That,
no, absolutely.
Yeah, they. So I roughed up.
They'd been through the ringer. It looked like they'd been moved a couple times maybe, and
doesn't
you
Steve
know.
Hang those aluminum flags though?
He does. And the ones that are still hanging had the tag and the marker on it. But we couldn't locate 2, and then there was one that said, well, what's that blue flag over there on the other side of the water? That can't be anything
Do
that's part of us.
Do you think it was moved?
I don't think I don't know if that one was. No, I mean that flag looks exactly where RF1 probably is. It didn't seem like a realistic location.
And it's not to the edge of the property line. He didn't close
it
out.
Yeah, I don't know why it turns in.
I
don't know why it turns in right there when we originally were. So yesterday when we were out there, we didn't have this plan with us. We were going out to just kind of recheck some of the locations. Originally, when we couldn't locate RF2 and RF1, there's an area where it looks like leaves have been filled in the area by 1A in the stream. My interpretation while I was out there was, oh, I know RF1 jets in. Maybe he's considering this filling as bank.
Oh, it's bank.
But, you know, it was pretty clearly just leaves that are being raked into the But it should, I mean, this line, as far as I can tell, there's no point in which it would turn like this. It should just be going straight towards the property line.
Yeah, I'm not, I personally am not comfortable with this area next to lot 14. I would like to see a continuation where what we think the riverfront area it is. It's just sort of lost in space here.
Yeah.
So.
So call for a site visit with Steve Erickson and get this
surveyed.
Yeah, get this figured out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Would it be possible to get the GPS on this one since it's been kind of a moving target?
Yeah, I think we had said that in the future we want GPS locations.
This might be a
good
one.
Does the 10 have a handheld GPS, Chuck?
I've never used it, but I heard it was from the 70s. So
no, that's not true. They had GPS.
That's right.
I have.
We did send one of the interns out into
the
field
well.
With it, and he came back with a sprained elbow or something. I don't, but
I've got a really good Magellan one. Can use that.
How is it in
tree
thick
cover?
Because sometimes you can't. It's hard to get the satellite.
Never had a problem in the White Mountains with it, so I think it's probably okay in Redding.
Right. Awesome.
So
great.
We can use that. I can either lend it to you or I can go with you, depending on when we do it.
Sounds fine.
And once we do agree, the either the plans or a note or something, the filings to have a GPS location.
Or should Steve be doing it?
Why are we doing
it? Yeah, I don't know why we'd be doing it, actually.
Just have the applicant.
Yeah.
So usually what ends up happening, if you guys are worried about it, they'll have the surveyor come in right behind us.
Right.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
So if
that's
that can
idea.
Happen, I mean, bring the GPS.
You could always
and
confirm.
I have one too, but it has, I know that mine has an accuracy within 5 feet, so that's not going to help anybody.
All right. So I guess we will continue this.
Until we find the flags.
Yep. Any questions from the public?
Just like the Pedagogy, 117 Arcadia, out of next door. I did find R2. It is out there.
Did you see R2?
I did see R1, assuming
no.
It is out in the water. So I agree with that. So my review is, there is an orange stake, which I asked last time if you didn't cite the lead. What is that? What is that?
Is that the top of the hill?
Top of the hill, yeah.
That's just the survey point where they took all the shots.
So it's likely their reference point
yeah.
for survey.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody uses different symbols and different tools for everything else, but it's likely that the surveyor put in this stake to so he can reference back to it whenever he shows up back at the site.
Do they reference it off of something like on the road and
yeah.
then they put something up there and then they shoot?
He can't take a straight shot because if you guys know the site, there's a hill that goes up and then down. So he's got to get something that's up towards the top of the hill and then work his way back down to actually get.
And then, so you're going to move flag 8-5?
Well, we're actually not going to move any flags, and we're going to go out with a Steve Erickson and figure out where these things go once and for all, and then they'll be moved.
With them there.
Oh, yes. Your name?
Greg Salvatelli, 25 Armand Avenue. Just some clarification for some of the conversations you had earlier. I know it's more familiar to you, but for the boundary line, and you're talking about from the river to the height of the bank, what is it that you're looking at? Are you looking at the growth from the riverbank or from the river edge, or what is being actually factored into this? You mentioned so I just wanted to know what you guys are going to look
BVW,
at.
BVW, boring vegetated wetlands. BVDs or something else.
There are a couple of jurisdictional areas out there. BVW is bordering vegetated wetland, and that's identified by vegetation, soil, and hydrology. And we've kind of come to some concurrence on where that line is. And then there's another additional jurisdictional area, which is called a riverfront area. And that's measured at the median high watermark. Mean high watermark. And if it were a real well-defined area, it would be the bank. But this is kind of a very flat area, and it meanders. So the DEP has given us and consultants, you know, indicators of how to figure that out, and that's what we've been discussing. And we've Chuck took a look. Chuck Taroni, our administrator, along with Mike and Amy, the other day, and it was their feeling that because of the slope, and that was one of the indicators. If there's a big change in the slope, then that would be indication of a mean high watermark, and there is a 8A, and there's a very flat area, and then it slopes up pretty quickly at 8A, and it was their feeling that during a mean annual high water event, that it would bleed up to that location. So that's, it's not a lot of footage.
Right.
You know, we're not gaining a lot of jurisdictional area by that, but we want to make it as clear and as precise as possible.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions from the public? Yes, sir.
Eric Warner, 30 Arnold Avenue. I live across from that. There was a conversation, I think, in the last meeting in terms of when the last time the wetland was actually measured to define the size of the wetland. What you just explained, does that account for that? I guess it's like a three-year, every 3 years you sort of look at that and say, you know, based upon erosion and things that, you know, wetlands grow.
Once we determine the jurisdictional areas, that plan is valid for 3 years.
Okay.
That's what that means. I think
so that's
your...
So that's what you'll be doing in this next survey?
Yes, plan. Once we agree to the two lines, then that plan is approved by us, and it's good for 3 years.
Okay, so I guess the question is, it sounded like that happened 3 years ago, or right at that line.
No.
The TAN does not go out and delineate wetlands throughout the town every 3 years or ever. We couldn't possibly afford to do that. The way that it works is that the landowner or the applicant, if they want to do something, the burden is on them to make that delineation, and then we go out and confirm it or alter it. We don't make that delineation on our own. We just confirm or take issue with what a land property owner.
Any other questions?
Hi, Lisa Roche, 117 Arcadia as well. So now the wetland growth that you're talking about, so when everything's starting to pop now. I'm sure if you were there last night, you saw it. I'm seeing like a lot of the skunk cabbage, and his line is not, doesn't match with the wetland growth. Is that what you're gonna determine on your walk, or is that Mr. Erickson's?
Mr. Erickson has put out his flags, and we have looked at those flags, and we have concurred with those flags as to the location of the bordering vegetated wetland. What is in question right now is the location of the riverfront area, but that's not based on vegetation.
Was there any skunk cabbage observed upland of those A-series flags yesterday?
I didn't notice any.
I have some photos if you'd like to see them.
Sure, we can.
Sure.
We can see photos.
Do you have any way to show where the flags are, though?
Flags are in the photos.
Yeah. Mike, were you, Dave Rochi, 117 Arcadia, were you down there 8, 7,
We were. Yeah.
She's gonna show you.
Here, here. You can see the skunk cabbage coming up here.
water's that way.
Toward me?
The water is that way.
Right, okay.
This is going
up the hill.
Up the hill.
Right. And, yeah, so the skunk cabbage looks like it's down of that.
Of that flat.
Right, yeah. And the water is over here.
Correct.
Right.
The water's.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, well.
There's one right there.
Well, yeah, that's just one below, but all this is in the wetlands.
Right, because it's a river.
I know. Well,
taking pictures.
We kind of just said it last minute. Oh, we should stop on it. You said last week.
And then.
Oh, there's
the next one. There's the next flag.
Well, let's do some due diligence.
Going that way.
It was a good thing we did our due diligence. That's why we do.
Well, it's good to have one.
Yeah. Madam Chair, we are going to do another site visit.
So, yeah, so
this will be.
We're going to have Steve Erickson out there. I'm sorry, Anika.
Yeah, go ahead.
We're going to have Steve Erickson out there to look at the riverfront line. At the same time, we can look at the flags. I mean, I think that's it's prudent to do that. We're going to be out there. We're going to be walking the same line. It's not any.
So we're going to continue this and have further site inspections. So, and that's that.
I move we continue the hearing on the for Low Meadow, that 14 lot 15.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you. Thank you, folks.
May 11th. May 11th.
Okay, now it's May, June.
Here.
All right. Request for determination of applicability 2016-9 vegetation management activities along the purple line maps NA lot NA Keolis Commuter Services continued. Are we continuing this? Nope.
I'm here.
Oh, okay. Excellent. And your name, sir?
My name is Kyle Fair. I'm from Fair Germany and I'm a representative of Keolis Commuter.
Great.
I'll start by asking, I know the commission has taken this up before because I was going to make the meeting. Do you feel comfortable going forward with just questions you have, or would you prefer that I make the full presentation and explain the maps in the right of way?
I think we can go right into our questions.
Okay,
do you feel?
I think that's fine.
Yeah. Okay. So, I did have some questions. You're using Aquanet, right? And that's the is it mostly glycophosphate?
The glyphosate, yes.
And when do you folks do your applications? What time of the year?
The application, it is scheduled in the YIP, but the application is scheduled between, I believe it's June 17th to July 18th. It's a 1 month period. That is published and notices go out in the Herald and the Globe to let people know.
So you do that system wide in that 1 month period?
They do, surprisingly enough. That's why we do take a month though, is because obviously if there are rainy days they can't apply. Windy days obviously, because this is a foliar application done, you know, that's the rail, it's done about this far, so it is a missed foliar application, so you don't find wind, obviously you should get drift and you want
is
to
it done from a vehicle on the tracks?
I can show you if you'd like.
I don't know.
It is done
just
from a vehicle.
I'm curious.
No. It actually helps a lot to pass these pictures around. That is the application vehicle, and it is spraying in that picture, just to give you an idea. So it is an on-track vehicle. I will state that the chemicals used are really out of our hands. EAR specifies what chemicals chemicals are used in the
DAR.
What's DAR?
The chemicals come off of their sensitive area material list, which is prescribed for the sensitive zones that you see on the map there, the dark blue, the light blue. I will say that even the undelineated upland areas, as we call them, or in this case, they're more urban areas, those get the sensitive application as well, only because the logistics of having multiple trucks and multiple mixtures out there is very costly. If you get towards the back, you'll see some of my Dire Straits places that obviously are not here. Those are for some of my freight railroads.
So you don't do... Oh, no, that's about the same type of situation. So it looks like the spraying basically stays to the gravel bed.
So what is it? It's a 10-foot pattern either side of center line is what it's designed for. That truck there that is spraying, he's spraying a 10-foot pattern. So on a developed, very, very big right-of-way, like a commuter right-of-way we have here, especially since it is like a track in most places, it's pretty much limited to the ballast and the shoulder of the ballast.
Yeah,
Just as a matter of just to let you know, Keolis is not in the best of financial situations. So they've decided to take an approach, and they've reduced their pattern to an 8-foot pattern either side of center line to cut costs. We're not going to redelineate 650 miles of commuter right away for that, so we're keeping the delineation for 10 feet because they always could go back to it if they needed to, but for cost cutting measures, they have decided to cut it down to 8 feet, so you are getting an extra 2 feet of buffer to the central areas.
No, 2 feet. Right.
It sounds like this spraying is done annually.
Yes.
Do you know why it's done annually? Like, is it
costs?
Could you get away with doing it less frequently?
So it is a safety thing because you gotta remember you're not just spraying these pristine tracks that you have trails over, you're spraying side tracks that don't get as much
use.
You're spraying switches, you're spraying bungalows for signal operations, you're spraying wide crossings in order to make visibility an issue because there are still barely a number of surface crossings.
Yeah.
The blue zones that you see though, because they are near sensitive areas that just like to demand the regulations protect, the blue zones only get one application for you. The dark blue zones, because it's protecting surface water recharge areas, the dark blue areas get one application every 2 years. This is actually a year they will be spraying the dark blue zones. They just throw that in there because it's an even year.
Yeah. Yeah.
So wouldn't the spray unit is 10 feet on each side of the center line?
We're delineating for 10 feet either side of the center line, then we spray 8 feet either side of the center line.
Right. So
especially in those sensitive areas.
So my recollection from last meeting was that we had a question relative to the maps that we used. Was it USGS maps versus...
I believe you did go back and did you pick up...
We overlaid the wetland layers that Redding has specific. At least along the right of way, I did not check the entire town because I don't need to, but along the right of way, it matched with the mass GIS layers that we already had. There were no additional vernal pools or additional sensitive areas or wetlands shown.
Okay.
We did overlay it, yes.
Thank you.
What would be the process? I see that the area, the light blue area next to the certified vernal pool, kind of dead center of town there, you know what I'm, the area I'm talking about.
Yep.
That area is light blue, but it's a budding, a dark blue, so less frequent spray zone.
Meaning where it crosses.
The IWPA, yeah. What would be the process to get that lighter blue area near the certified vernal pool changed over to a different spraying frequency? There is no process.
The dark blue is specifically for drinking water.
Right.
Water recharge. The light blue is for sensitive.
I mean, the change in color is just a change in frequency.
Yes.
You said the light blue, they only spray once a year.
Both the light and the dark, yes, I'm sorry, yes. The colors indicate a frequency. Light blue is once a year, dark blue is once every 2 years.
So what is the frequency for the non-blue areas?
The non-blue areas, the frequency is they could spray again, but there are so many non-blue areas mixed within the blue areas, they don't ever, and I've been doing this for 15 years, they've never sent a truck out to do another right-of-way application.
Okay.
They could, in those areas, potentially spray for brush.
Yeah.
But they're in the middle of town. There isn't any brush.
Oh, okay.
So you wouldn't do that, and they don't use this to knock back trees. One, it's ineffective, and two, there's no point in it. So any trees, which is usually what the issue is in urban areas, trees are cut. I will say that anything in yellow zones are cut as well. So anything that needs to happen within the yellow no spray zones, they go out and cut, hand remove, or manually remove it.
So how are these intervals decided upon?
How did...
For different sections of track.
They were decided on before I was born.
A long time ago.
Yeah, I mean, the right-of-way management regulations came about in response to the Wetlands Protection Act being passed, basically because you weren't really able to maintain the right-of-way very well with herbicides at that time because of the setbacks that were required under Wetlands Protection. So there was a presumption, excuse me, in the Wetlands Protection Act that as long as you were doing this work with the protected zones in the right-of-way management regulations, as long as you're doing that in the coordination with the vegetation management plan and the yearly operational plan, that there is no adverse effects to the wetlands. Now, who decided that? I'm guessing DEP and DAR, but in years since, there have been tests done or on drift and on migration in the soils and stuff by DAR, and they have found no significant traces of drift or migration beyond, I think they said, 6 to 18 inches deep in the soil and somewhere between a foot and 18 inches beyond the actual edge of the spray pattern. Can't quote you on that, but I can send Chuck.
I'd like to see that.
I
take your word at it. I'm not asking to question what you're saying. I just would like to
read. They did one of their tests was in, I believe, Boxborough, and the other one down in Attleboro.
Okay.
And that was done in 2003 in order to establish whether these 10-foot setbacks were adequate. I will say that the 10-foot setback, actually, as far as spraying near water or water over wetlands, is a label requirement as well. So these applicators who have very interesting regulations here in the Commonwealth, these applicators that do apply outside of the state are very familiar with the 10-foot setback too. And these, as far as the applicator they use, which is RWC out of Westfield, they are lifers at this company. You know, it's a very good company. They keep their employees very happy. So you've got people out there spraying these right away that have been doing it for 10, 15 years. They're very older.
Very familiar.
Yes.
Do these chemicals break down? Are they very quickly?
They're pretty much, I mean, they're considered immobile in soil once they actually get there. And as you saw from the application, they're using the lowest label rate. You could have any one of the homeowners that just left go out to True Value and grab a bottle of Roundup, which is glyphosate, and it will kill their dandelions in 48 hours. This stuff gets a kill somewhere between 7 and 10 days. You'll have it start turning brown. So it is a very light application, and it is considered immobile in the soils.
So the scheduling of the trucks, I assume that actual scheduling? It's not like a one specific time of day. It's whenever the rail gives you permission to be on the track.
Yes, and that can change.
Which can change,
it's
depending on their... They have to clear the line for you to
and
be
they,
there. And,
yes, or
yeah.
at least one track.
Yeah.
Right.
So there's really no way to predict what time of day you would be out there.
Yeah,
or,
I mean, obviously, morning rush and evening rush, there's not going to be any trucks out there doing it. They're going to attempt to do most of their application in off hours, which can be, and I know around the city and in particularly busy areas, they are planning to do 10 p.m. to 6 a.m.
middle of the night. Yeah.
I will note that these zones are brightly marked between the rails out there,
yeah.
So that with the lights of the truck and the spotlights of the actual application vehicle, it's very easy to see them. We do have a wetland scientist that will be riding the trucks. They do every year. They've hired, I can't remember the name of the firm, but Keolis, the person that rode last year from their environmental department, is pregnant, so they've actually hired someone this year to ride the trucks that is a wetland scientist.
And what's that role of that person?
They help spot. They have spot obviously the zones that are out there, but clearly we don't delineate ditches, drainage ditches along the right of way as being wetlands. Some of them are persistently wet, some of them stay wet even throughout July. That wetland scientist will help identify areas that need to be sort of spot, you know, spray zones for the year just because of the presence of water. Because like I said, these applicators are kind of held by the, not only by the regulations here in the state, but also by label regulations. If DAR were on the truck doing a spot inspection of the actual process and they were to observe, even though they're going through an upland area, but they're spraying in water that is clearly running in the drainage ditch, that would be a violation. So the wetland scientist is there to help identify these.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you for all the information.
No problem.
I don't have any other questions.
Any other questions from the commission?
How fast is this truck going? I mean, if we're stopping the spraying, starting, it's done at 10 o'clock at night.
It's a good question because it seems like it wouldn't happen, but if you saw the switchboard on the inside of this thing, that stuff goes off quick. This thing that you see down here is actually an actuated stopper that as you stop it, it is hydraulically activated to come under and catch any of the drippage that could potentially happen from the loose nozzle. They do inspect the truck daily. As far as fast, like speed, I would guess anywhere between 15 and 25 miles an hour. It's
pretty fast.
It is pretty fast, and considering they're just spraying a little bit of mist out there, you can imagine how.
Well, especially if you're stopping and starting it, and it looks like from the picture there's some breakage in the track, or there's no spraying in that area. Right?
Yeah.
So that's pretty fast if you're stopping, starting. I'm wondering if it's just being sprayed, yet if there's no starting. We don't care, which is good.
Well, I mean, if that were the real concern, I think you'd have seen. Let me see if I can kind of give you an idea, because I think you have a pretty good description.
So, how many miles is this far?
The right of way, as far as the entire commuter right of way, is about 650 total miles.
Yeah, it's 15 miles an hour.
Grand.
It must be.
The number of cars, trucks.
And that's the driest season, June to July.
Sorry, I don't either can't find it or I didn't include it. But it does, you can identify these, especially because this delineation has been pretty historically the same. Maybe some minor changes in the field with the beaver activity, a lot of towns. When we go out, we might expand, especially in a year like this year where we're examining them a little more intensely. You know, it's always possible to expand some of these a little bigger because of beaver activity, but these established, especially around culverts and stuff, you can see it. You can be driving, I mean, you can see it probably from the train if you had a head-end view and you're sitting on the side. There is an encroachment. It's not a big encroachment, so you can tell that they're not spraying.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, we're 30 or so years into this whole thing, and I think if there were that issue, especially the DAR spot checks and them enforcing it, especially if you're going to go to the extent of having regulations quite like this, I think we would have had an issue and had it solved already.
It sounds to me like you guys get all your bases covered.
Yeah. Well, do you want to tell the person paid me that?
Chuck, do you have any questions?
I don't have any questions.
Any further questions from the commission?
No.
Any questions
great.
From the public? Okay, hearing none.
I make a motion for a negative determination for RDA 2016-9, vegetation activity management activities.
Second.
But how long is this good for?
It's good for the life of the BMT, which is a 5-year BMT.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Could you send just a link for those articles to our administrator? Do you mind? Thank you. Thanks for coming in.
Okay. We have another ANRAD, abbreviated notice of resource area delineation, 270-0660-116 Van Norden Road, map 39, lot 72, Gately Hill. This came before us last year. We had a site visit on a Monday afternoon, as I recall, and we met with Steve Erickson from Norse Environmental, the property owner, Chuck Taroni, myself, Mr. Flynn, and Jack Sullivan. Anybody else? I can't remember. But we did, Brian Sullivan. We reviewed the bordering vegetated wetland line, and we had some changes made at the time, bringing up that wetland a little further towards more of the upland area. And there is a development to the west that this wetland is a continuation of, and Chuck actually put a zero flag, and it's an orange tape on a tree so that it connects with the delineation from next door.
We usually request it on by 17th.
We had a site visit on Sunday, and we did ask that one of the flags be moved 5 feet further to the west. And do you recall which number was that?
Yes, 23D.
23D. I don't know if it's been conveyed to Mr. Erickson, and if that's...
I think we should be looking at the plan with it moved already.
Oh, you have it?
Yes, that looks different from what I have.
Oops.
That's the revised plan,
Chuck.
Yeah.
23D, it's got to be down in here.
Yeah, that's different from the plan that we have.
Yeah.
There you go.
Here. Yeah, that's it.
Oh, it's not over there.
It's this one.
I didn't get the new plan.
I don't have the new plan.
This is a revised plan. I sent
just
an email to Jack,
gotcha,
requesting that move, and he's sent the plan out with the revision.
Where's my lot? I don't know. Everyone else has.
Jack, this is the one dated, the one I had, the old one is April 5th. But this is a new one.
Yeah, just to introduce myself for the record, Jack Sullivan, Sullivan Engineering Group. So on Monday, Chuck said there was a site walk done. There was one flag to be moved. I made the revision. That's the original plan date. There's a revision block right there.
4/26.
The revision block,
okay.
It should be a date of 4/26/16.
Okay.
And the request was made Monday, and I made the changes on Tuesday. And I believe Karen just dropped the plans off today, but I had sent an electronic copy to Chuck right away.
It was just the 23B that was moved?
It's just the
23D.
One flag. So I adjusted that 5 feet in an upland direction, and then I adjusted the 25, 35, and 100 foot buffer.
Just refresh.
Want to get into the new plans right there?
I know that when we did this about a year ago, we said, okay, just connect this one to this one.
Which I did.
And so on this plan, you don't see 11-12D and 9D, but they're still out in the field, correct?
Correct.
All right.
So there's one section right here. Those 14D, 13D, 10D.
Yes.
There was an 11D here and a 12D
right.
here.
Yep.
We
right.
said let's eliminate those two, and we made the connection right through. So the flags, I think we might have actually removed the flags at that time.
No, they're still there.
They're still there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's why it's a little confusing.
They're out. Smoothly, nine is gone. We did the same thing at between 10 and 9.
Right.
10 and 8, I'm sorry.
It was down in this area where there were some changes requested.
Yep.
But the plan reflects what was asked for, but if need be, I could remove 9D, 11D, and 12D just in the field so there's no confusion.
At some point, yeah.
Yeah.
If, I have a question, if I go up to the board.
Go ahead.
Having not been on the site, I'm operating in the dark, but it looks to me, okay, in this B series, where is the wetland? Because you say the 20-foot buffer is there, right? 25-foot line is right there.
Yeah.
From which line, the B series or the E series?
Just in, from this, the B series here, there's a 25-foot line. You can see, if you look at the B series, and then it runs, it's almost a straight line. So it's reflective of the C series and the B series.
So the wetland is between the E series and the B series?
Correct.
And then over here.
It's wet all over here.
This is the wetland?
Right. So the wetland's between the B and E series here. There's a pipe here that discharges and gets wet all through here. They're not connected. There's a little upland area here.
That's the C series?
That's the C series. And then there's a little footbridge right here.
Are the D series and the C series connected? Are they continuous?
Can't remember if they connect or not.
Which two series, Jamie?
I don't think they're connected. Is the D, yeah.
Well, it looks like 28D.
They connect right here. He connected the D to 1C. Yeah, and then it comes around.
So, Jack, now I'm a little confused. The B, E, is that draining to the north? Is it?
I show a flow arrow here. It's flowing this way. See the flow arrow right here?
So it connects to the whole wetland area, right?
Right.
So it's all going this way?
I think it's a northerly direction. It's all flowing.
South.
South.
Okay, I can see the north arrow.
Yeah, none of us is going this way.
Yeah, I'm upside down. It's flowing south.
Yeah, okay. Because I thought, is there flow? Did we see flow?
No.
No? Okay. I just thought that it was all connected.
It's not, well, there's a small portion of brook that's between Lot A and 128 Van Norden, right along the road. Right up here, there's a small brook up here.
Mm-hmm.
But it's standing water and there's no pipe that drains into it. And then there's this little land bridge that's between 1B and 6A.
1B?
1B and 6A, right between the word shed and, so in this area, there's almost a little.
Oh, a land bridge.
There's like a little land bridge that separates the open channel on the right from the open channel on the left. And there's no connection from the open channel on the right, delineated by the A series flags. No connection from the A series water to the B series water.
Well, where's the A series water draining?
It doesn't. It's just basically an open ditch.
It looks like there's runoff from a 12-inch CMP drain.
But
where is
I didn't see that.
Yeah,
we looked for it. You looked for it. We didn't see it, but maybe it's buried.
I feel like we located it back in August.
Did you?
Yeah, I think we.
I looked on the
Yeah, I didn't see it.
Yeah, we were looking for it, but.
When I was out doing the survey, I actually looked between the B and C series to see if I could find a pipe or anything.
Yeah.
I couldn't find anything. And I think what Anika is saying,
between
correct,
B and
I think
C.
The water drains into that area, there's no piped outlet from it. It just goes in and either dissipates into the ground.
So is there?
I showed the flow direction, but you noted on my plan, it was totally dry when I was out there, but that was last summer.
Yeah,
but
there was water there
this
week.
This spring.
But between, so there's one little land bridge between A and B flags. And Jack, if you want to plan, do you have a?
Chuck has it up.
Yeah.
The other, Chuck.
I do.
PDF.
Thank you.
There's plenty of flags on this plan.
Yeah.
So there's a little, I'm calling it a land bridge. It's just, you know, there's grass between.
A and B series?
Six, yeah, the A series and the B series between the word shed,
right
in that area.
Right, yeah,
and
yeah.
And so does that, I missed it, but is there also another similar sort of thing between 10B and 1C?
10B.
As you head south? Yeah.
1C, right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's
is there also another?
There's not like a wooden bridge, but there's like a pathway. Through
an earth pathway.
An earth pathway.
And it's not piped, the water
it's
from.
It's not piped.
It's not piped, so
I tried to find a pipe to see it. I couldn't
yep.
find one.
Okay.
So hydrologically, it's not connected?
Well,
correct.
By groundwater. Groundwater could flow, could mimic surface water flow in this area.
But it's not piped.
But it's not. It's not a fast movement.
Does 1B connect with AD? In other words, see where it
yeah.
says brook dry? Is the word dry in a resource area?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So similarly, does 10B connect with 1E?
It was off the property, so I don't
okay.
I didn't make that connection.
Yeah, this is like a ditch, Jamie. So E and B are one
okay.
side of the other.
Yeah, so that should be connected, right?
From here to here?
Yeah, I'm asking, but I think people said yes.
Like, I know in this case he just brought the flag to the property line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In this case, when he was flagging, I don't think where this shed encroaches onto the other property, I don't
right.
think he realized.
Yeah.
You
so
know what I mean? It should have probably ended at 4B and should have ended at 3A.
Yes.
But when he was out there and saw the shed, he just assumed that, so he hung flags.
So that was my puzzlement. So lot 128 is a separate property, separate owner?
Correct.
And 24.
There's a house here, and there's a house here, set separate ownerships.
So really the E line and the, well, the E line doesn't really matter to us. It's not impacting
this
property.
Right, right.
Well, it affects
it's additional
lot
information.
Lot, does it? No.
No,
the
it's,
doesn't
it's additional
affect,
information.
It confuses us.
Well, no, no,
right,
no,
thought,
no,
thought
except on
really
the other side.
It gives
yeah.
you an idea.
Well, no,
no,
on the
no,
other
no,
side
I mean,
of the path area.
Right here.
Yeah.
That's true. That's true. That's true.
It's just the lot property lines are.
So
okay.
we are not delineating resources on lot 74 or 73.
Correct.
We're only delineating resources on lot A. However, if there is a resource on lot 73 in the 35-foot setback affects lot A, we would need to know that.
Right. And I think the E series and part of the BD,
in
the 100, Anik was right, you see
yeah.
the 100-foot BVW buffer zone.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Right.
We did not, I did not walk the E series flags.
Well,
did anybody else walk those E series flags? Because those E series flags are significant to the 100-foot BVW
yeah.
buffer zone. So it wasn't walked?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Oh, I see.
Okay.
Do we know if it was walked back in August?
I don't remember either.
I mean,
I know we were more concentrating on the back.
So when we went out to the site the first time back in August, we walked over that bridge pretty quickly.
Yeah.
That was my recollection.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then we slowed down just beyond it.
Yeah.
So what does that mean?
I don't remember.
It made sense.
I mean, they might be good, but I don't think we verified those flags.
What do you want me to do?
The giant that you had opened before.
We would.
Okay.
We would only have to go about as far as 3E.
So Mass DEP shows that those are intermittent streams out there, and the water flows in this direction down.
Where are we?
Oh,
here. Okay, I got it.
Okay. But doesn't it show what's on the southern? Oh, that's pretty far away, pretty far out in. Could you show the bottom
the
part
X
of the lot, the southern tip?
Flood zone X.
Oh, it shows it right there. So that's intermittent. It's not perennial.
Is 72 part of this parcel?
Yes.
So it shows a channel.
But we don't see any flags out there.
Because this is pretty much all
I think
wetland.
It's all wetland.
It's all wetland. It's
yes,
very low, and it goes into this other area.
The D series flags, so 5D, 4D, 3D, those are delineating.
So that's the northern border of the wetland.
And everything to the left of that line is wetland.
Mm-hmm.
Including that intermittent stream.
So this intermittent stream feeds what watershed, Chuck? The high school?
You know, it might get down into the Abajona.
The Abajona.
Yeah.
Okay.
It might, but it's pretty much kind of confined from Forest, Van Norton, and Colburn.
It's so pretty far upper reach.
So when we checked all this quite with stream stats when the development went in, and it's an intermittent stream for sure.
Okay.
It's not a big watershed.
Yep. Okay. So during site visits, we saw some debris out there too.
Yeah, I think that's being worked on. I have the owner with me. I know Karen went and met with the building inspector. They're working on cleaning it up.
Yeah.
We know there was a neighbor complaint, and they're in the process of trying to deal with it.
Okay.
It's a nice potato chip truck.
It's a great truck. It's a great truck.
It's a collectible.
Two large things that really stood out during the site visit while we were in the really back side of it was near somewhere in the vicinity of, I can't remember exactly, flag 4D or 2D. There was a big, huge, rolled up piece of chain link fence.
Stop.
Yeah, right there. You know, kind of out thrown in the wetlands out back there. Also, I don't know if it was near 3D, but there were some large railroad ties.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Also dumped there. It looked like that area between 4 and 2D was sort of an area of historic fill.
I actually remember that on the site walk, while we were trying to walk back there, it seemed like a filled area.
It was a little difficult
to walk. I don't know if any of the other members remember that, but it definitely was a filled
area. Yeah.
And you also have power line and a hose running out back there. Did you guys open this?
I haven't been out there for a while.
there's a.
It's like a cord or something, yeah.
Well,
yep.
No, there's a.
An overhead power
line.
Power
up in
line.
The trees.
Yep. Yeah. I think it powers the power tools in the shed.
We're working on that.
Yeah. So yeah, there was some housekeeping stuff going on.
So for purposes of the INRAD.
At this point, I would like to I'd like to know if we can go out and verify the 28D, 10B, 1E, you know, some of those flags on 24 Herald Ave. And I recognize that's not your property, but that would be wetlands, jurisdictional wetlands that we would need an accurate setback for.
Which flags?
All the ones on, well,
You're looking up through here, 20, like 28D.
Yeah, I think 10B, only
20.
I think only up to 3E.
I think 3E is the limiting one. And
because at that point, the 100-foot is kind of right.
Our lot frontage.
Right. I don't think we need to go much past 3E. E, yeah, 3E. But I'd like to hear from other members.
I agree with you. I didn't really have any objection to anything on the B series, the A series, or the D series with that one change. So I think it really came down to, and I hadn't really paid attention to it until we're looking at it now, because I think
right.
It looked like it was someone else's property, so we didn't even look over there for flags.
That was it.
Procedurally, Chuck, are we allowed to go on?
No.
You're not? Or are?
On someone else's property? No, you
no.
can only go on the property
that's
that the notice is filed for.
You can request.
You could ask, yeah.
Yeah.
But that wasn't the question. But yes.
Yeah. Okay.
can we go through that process and just see?
We would have to ask.
I could reach out to the homeowner and just ask. I think the lot lines are, like, somewhat, they're so skewed, and when the botanists originally went out, they're going off of, I hadn't done any survey work, so they just flagged it.
Yep.
But I could reach out to the homeowner. If they say no, then...
Then they say no.
Yep. Right. And that would be the best we could
that's
do.
That's what we got.
Off,
yeah.
Or there'd be no determination as to the E-series. But I could put a request in writing to the owner and try to see
I'd
if
appreciate
they can get
that.
Permission.
Is there a house on 74, lot 74?
Yes.
Yeah.
It was built, I believe, in the 90s, so that there is a plan showing wetlands on the property with, you know, I think
oh.
it was built in like 1994. It's not an old home.
Right.
Oh, you've
so
seen
you,
that plan
you guys
for?
We should have the absolute.
Yeah, I have the plan.
The owner
is that
might be here. He was here and he's been stepping out.
Oh,
great.
So
well, let's invite him in. See.
Yeah. But it's not an old home. And there,
but
it
will give you an idea.
Notice intent in order, and there was a proposed plan. I'm not sure if there was an aspect.
I wouldn't either.
Okay.
It did show wetlands on the property.
Myself.
It's a tricky situation to need to somebody else's permission to get the jurisdictional area delineated on your own land.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, well. Good try.
Was that before the good part?
Yeah.
Any other questions?
There is a procedure we can get on their land without their permission for this, but it's not.
I think if it's if people really are concerned about that 100-foot, then we'll try to get access.
We may be able to tell from the line. My recollection
yeah.
of this area was that the beginning was pretty well easily defined.
Yeah.
It was just when we got towards
people.
The back that was
yeah.
difficult. So.
Okay.
Chuck, could you pull out the application for that lot?
74, sure.
Okay. So I guess we will continue.
I move we continue the SANRAD to the next meeting, which is what, May? Help me out, Chuck. May 11th?
May 11th, yeah.
I'll second.
Can you just, what information have we asked for?
We've asked for a site visit to review line.
E-series.
E-series.
B-series.
E.
The flags
E.
on 24
E.
Harold
it's
Ave.
Correct.
Do you want a site visit with Steve Erickson or just the commission?
Well, we cannot get on the E-series because it's a part of the property.
But we're going to try to get
we're
approval
try,
to do that.
What else are we asking for? What else do we need to do? That's the only open issue?
Yeah. And I wouldn't mind taking a look at the other areas as well.
Which other areas?
Towards the shed, in that area. I didn't pay much attention.
Oh, up at the front?
Yep. So.
The B is the ditch.
Yeah,
yeah,
I think
I
that's very well defined.
It's really
well defined.
Are the
it is well
still
defined.
Under Jack?
Yes.
Any questions from the public?
That one stays.
Are asking the commission what is there for jurisdiction, what's under our jurisdiction. I don't know, and we say yes or no, and we take a look at what is wetland, you know, under our jurisdiction and within 100 feet of that wetland. Beyond that, we don't know what they have plans for this property, but I suspect they have some plans for it. Within 100 feet, they have to notify us if they are making any plans. And then we have a 25-foot line from the edge of the wetland up 25 feet into the upland area. There's no disturbance. And then within the wetland line, 35 feet. That's a no structure. From the 35 to 100 feet, they could put, you know, structures, roadway, what things that they might want to develop as. And but
as
that area would have to come before us, and we would have to evaluate that in lieu of protection, in to see how it would protect the wetland resource area. Any other questions from neighbors? Okay, we had a.
Did you
say motion?
I second.
A second.
I do think that this is one in particular that we want GPS locations for each one of these flags submitted with for the record when we issue the PAN record.
That shouldn't be a problem, right?
The coordinates.
Yeah.
All those in favor? Okay.
Just what about Steve? Did you need him on the site visit? He was the original delineator of the wetlands. Or is this something the commission's going to do on their own?
I think we can do it on our own.
We may be able to do it on our own. Do we need permission first, though? Does the applicant need to let us know when a permission's? So, I mean, that's the first step.
That's
for
it,
right?
If we can get
right.
on,
yes,
for the east areas.
Right. You know, I'll say if the applicant wants Steve to be there, I have no objections, but I don't think it's necessary that he be there.
And are we specifically? We're just looking at. Never mind. Forget it.
Okay. We all set? All right. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Old new business. Certificate of compliance for 30 Gavin Circle. Yeah. We've been out a couple times. They had a lot of down a couple of trees and
Right, that's across the street. I was thinking of one of
them. Yeah, exactly across the street, yep. And they're looking for a certificate of compliance for they're moving out. When we did our initial site investigation.
Right, I was on that.
Oh, okay. So you saw it.
Were they here 2 weeks ago? Did we tell them there's a bunch of junk in today?
Yes.
Did we continue or
continue 2 weeks?
We continued it.
We continued it. And they did.
It looks great. Except there's nothing growing.
So yeah.
It's just all bare earth.
It looks, well, I shouldn't say that. I quickly saw it last 3 weeks ago.
3 months.
3 weeks. We did a site visit.
Yeah.
Yeah, 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, I think
that was. Okay. So when we went yesterday, it looked like there was an area that hasn't come in yet. That no vegetation's grown. There's no mulch laid down. Possibly some potential for erosion.
Where was that?
Do we have a plan?
There's a plan.
That's the soil that you noticed, Anika.
So where's the driveway? Driveway's right here. This area here.
So you're saying between flag A3 and the building. So this area. And that's a high traffic area if you're walking from the driveway to the backyard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I thought there were portions all along, kind of within, not necessarily the whole 25-foot ZNV, but there are portions within the 25-foot ZNV. That's absolutely bare earth. Bare mulchy earth, but. I would love to see some attempt at establishing some growth in this area.
So what are you proposing?
I think at a minimum, some sort of seed, wetland seed, or something appropriate.
I would agree with that.
I don't know that wetland is gonna take. Is there a conservation mix, Chuck?
Yes, there is a conservation mix that you could put in there. Scratch it in, see what comes out.
Yeah, see what.
You're likely to have some volunteer growth. That's what was across the street. So.
Do you think it's invasive volunteer growth though, or is it going to be? I mean, those Phragmites are having a happy time.
I can't
over
tell,
there.
and those Phragmites will,
yeah, there are,
you know,
Phragmites
so
there,
head
so
up into the well, into the dry area. They always do.
Yeah.
I think
it would be beneficial to throw some native seed in there and see what.
Can
see
I
see what happens?
Suggest another idea.
Go ahead.
Since there are two big trees that were there and now gone, I think. What if we planted a tree there instead? Because I think there's a vernal pool that wet area.
It's across the street.
Well, right on this property. I guess it's
on
not necessarily a vernal pool, but it's just wet.
It's not a vernal pool.
It's just wet. It used to get a lot of shade. It doesn't get a lot of shade anymore. Mm-hmm.
It's my understanding that the trees that came down kind of acts of God sort of,
yeah,
damage.
Yep.
Situations, and based on what Chuck has informed me, we don't typically ask for replacement when there's damaged trees have
I'm just thinking
fell.
If you're going to spend, you know, $40 on seed or $30 on a little tree, maybe the tree is a better option.
Well, another thought is shrubs.
That would be fine. I think seed's going to have a hard time taking.
It might. It's shady. It's, you know, it's a little bit upland. It's not.
So we do have the applicant here, but I would tell you my thoughts on this. And they're selling the house and moving, so the best bang for the buck that the commission can do would be to mark that area as the wetland, like we do with the granite bounds, and for the future owners, so they'll know to stay out. And then maybe if that soil is looks unstable, maybe some hay in that area or mulch.
We can't ask for bounds now. If it wasn't in the order of conditions, we can't.
Yeah, you know, I didn't have a chance to look at the order of conditions, so I don't know. But it was written in 2009, so it's likely that it was there.
Well, if that was there, and the bounds are not there, we cannot order to comply.
I thought we had a discussion yesterday that we didn't think there was granite bounds in it because of how ridiculous the location of the granite bounds may end up looking.
Hmm.
I read it. I didn't see any granite bounds.
Well, that's a separate order.
That's not the order of conditions.
That's a separate order.
That's the continuing conditions that goes with the certificate of compliance. I think so, anyways.
File number.
Oh, section 32? That's in 1981, and I'm not sure what that order of conditions says, but I don't think granite bounds were asked for back in 1981.
That was for the original construction of the road across the wetland.
So we don't have the right order of conditions?
They might have been part of that order of
conditions. That order of conditions in your hand is for
the road?
There's two certificates of compliance requests, okay? And they were supposed to be separated. So do you have an order of conditions for the first one, for Jack's? 580?
270, 580.
Yep.
Yep.
You have that order of conditions?
No.
Okay.
No,
well, that's the one that the granite bounds would be in.
We have 1981-2, so that's completely different.
That's
yeah.
That's what we have.
And then there's a 1981-2.
Harry, is the sign on it?
Okay. What lot is this we're talking about? It's lot 4.
Why don't we take this one at a time?
Are you looking at this map? Well, I don't know that I have the other.
It's on the back side of
the
order of conditions.
That's the
you
old
should
1981
have
or 80,
it
81.
Eight,
no, that's actually, this
road.
Order of conditions is separate. This was to grant lot A to the Conservation Commission. If I read that right? Off of Pearl Street?
Yeah.
This doesn't have Galvin Circle on it. This is Pearl Street. And it's, I think, the other side of Pearl Street.
Well, but this is...
Yeah. I think it's not entirely clear what...
So there's two things,
let's find out
right?
From
this was never released.
From Galvin Circle.
Right.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's holding up the transfer.
Yeah. That much I know. What it's for, and I can also tell you that I went back to 1981, and Article 32, back in the day, was the Wetlands Protection Article. So although that number looks really, odd, it's correct. It matches up with the articles that we used back in 1981. So they would need a certificate of compliance for that, or partial.
So Article 31 is under the 10 bylaws.
Yeah.
But what about under the State Wetland Protection Act? Is there a companion order of conditions?
The order of conditions was sent out with the request for a certificate of compliance. And it would have the state, I mean, it would certainly have the state part of that, but it says right at the front, Town of Reading, General Bylaw, Section 32, Order of Conditions. So.
Yeah, well, we need to go back in our files, it was the state order of conditions ones. Or the order of conditions issued by the town under the State Wetland Protection Act.
The only thing we have is what's at the Registry of Deeds, and this is what we got from the Registry of Deeds. There's nothing in our files. So, my file, the files I know about start with 270. I don't know where to find 1981-2.
So I'm assuming this came up, an attorney did a title search, right?
Yeah.
He came up with this outstanding order of conditions. How did he apply this to 30 Gavin Circle? Because I don't see how 30 Gavin Circle identified this.
Do you have an answer to that? Do you want to introduce yourself and?
I'm Anna Luskin, live at 30 Gavin Circle. Hopefully, one more day.
But you get what I'm saying, right? I don't get why this doesn't reference 30 Gavin Circle, and it doesn't reference the reference lot numbers, but we don't know what lot number was originally the lot that 30 Gavin Circle went into. I'm going to assume, I guess, that somewhere in the lot, someone figured out it was lot 3, 4, 8, or 9, because that's what reference is before.
So somewhere there's something that says 30 Gavin Circle is lot number
4, 5, 3, 4, 8, or 9.
So if it was 8, how come 8 isn't the block of land that turned into Gavin Circle? Because it looks like that's where it would be.
You know what?
From that.
So I looked at Google Maps this morning to try to understand what section of Pearl Street this is and how it relates to Gavin Circle. And my best guess is Gavin Circle is over here.
Can we bring up the...
Because this is north.
I was going to say, Chuck, can you bring up a plot plan? And,
So that's Pearl where you're at, where your cursor is, right?
Right.
That's pretty far away from the yellow trim, it's 30 gallons.
See, so what I did is... This line.
Yeah, I've got you.
Is this? Here you've got the sewer easement. You've got the wetland. See lot A. See this?
Yeah.
So this is lot A, which is what is referenced in, which I never know really care about for poor Ms. Lusko over here.
No, but that really lines up with the lines on our plan.
Right.
And that has nothing to do with this location.
Sorry. Right, because these lots.
So that north arrow was right. Remember when we were talking about it?
Whereas the applicant's property is here.
Okay, so we can disregard this 1981-2 in regards to this property.
Except that we need to issue a certificate of completion so that she can transfer title.
Okay, so the specific conditions here were what?
Well, you wouldn't have had the bounds put in the 81, I'll tell you
no.
that.
No, that's what we're saying. It would only be on this other one.
So, and I think the reference to lot A was only... Oh, and condition 20 was submit an as-built plan.
Can I go down and get the other one while you guys are discussing?
Yeah,
sure. Yes, please.
Somewhere I saw reference to Law A being granted to...
You're making us dig. That's all right. We got to do it.
It was their attorney that
wrote this up. Yeah, why is attorney
doing title search? Right. Well, it's these loose ends that tend to tie up a lot of...
This is crazy. So can I just... number 12 says, this order of condition does not pertain to lots 1, 2, 5, 6... 7 and 10 of Gavin Circle subdivision.
Right, but that's on the subdivision plan.
Which we don't have in our
Which we don't plans. Have, right?
those lots may have been renamed.
Well, they have street numbers now.
Right.
Yeah, there's street numbers.
We don't know which one of those is Gavin's, is 30.
Right.
Which.
For the Gavin Circle, what was the original lot number?
Yeah.
Right.
We even know what subdivision it was.
Well, it's Gavin Circle.
It's calling this,
the
project location is Gavin Circle.
Permit says it's Gavin Circle.
Okay, so in item 13, it talks about a street crossing the wetland floodplain area. Should have a shoulder slope no less than 3:1.
We saw that, it's really really steep, right?
Yeah.
It is really steep?
Mm-hmm.
It is pretty steep from the road to the wetlands in that area. As a matter of fact, it's kind of in this vicinity here. So this 98-96 is this slope.
There's a bond posted for,
you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Is this, this is the street crossing.
Yeah.
Where's
over
the scale?
It's 1:20. You want a ruler? I mean,
yeah,
you can't.
Unless they've already claimed it.
Well, how could they?
There were conditions, if you look, I read that out. There was,
you know?
Yeah, there were conditions for release that they could have met.
And nor do I want them to make it flatter.
Right.
But it said
exactly.
In lieu of that,
exactly.
They could do all the work
stable.
Rather than rather than put the money up. So if you look, section 18, below A, B, and C, in lieu of a surety bond, the owner may deposit money or negotiable securities, yada, yada, yada. Each such bond in the amount of security may be reduced as the work progresses.
Right.
Each
somebody put up a bond, security, or cash.
But it could have been released as work progressed.
Mm-hmm. Wait.
So once they were able to show the work was done, they got their money back.
Without a certificate of compliance.
Could have. Didn't specify that here.
We have released bonds before the certificate. Well, I mean, this was back in. Well, you're a special case.
What's going on here?
You're a special case.
There must be a reason.
You know, I'm sure if we had a bond from the 80s, we would know it. Why don't you look into it? Get back to us in the next meeting. All right.
East of Pearl Street.
Yeah, one of them is $1,100, one of them is $1,600, and one of them is $3,500.
East.
I'm not going to pay attention to the bonds.
Yeah, the lawyer would take the $4,500 that you go back from the board.
And then you'd have to pay taxes.
Well, you know what they did?
Yep.
Now I get it. The conveyance of Lot A to the Conservation Commission was the consideration for the wetlands they filled in to put the road.
They probably own land over there.
Oh.
We want to fill in a little swamp over here. We'll give you a bigger swamp over there.
Oh.
I like it.
That works.
Good job, Harry.
Detective Chris.
It's not going to happen.
Already happened.
So, you know, we don't really have a problem with this. We're just trying to get to the bottom of that. You'll be able to, in all likelihood, sell the house tomorrow. So, okay, she's probably sitting there wondering, oh my God, they can sell tomorrow. What are they doing?
Yeah, but that Lot A is pretty far away from Galvin, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
But it's in the same reach, right?
It's still part of the watershed.
So, and they were allowing that back then.
Yeah, we wouldn't allow that.
Well, no, because they didn't replace the wetlands.
It was different then, too.
Yeah.
They traded.
Well, actually,
they didn't say it had to be in the exact same location. And
well, it's part
fact,
of the same watershed.
Right.
But even back then, you couldn't fill more than 4,000 square feet. And I wonder if they did.
But if you have no other means to access other than putting in a road, it's a limited project. Right.
Yeah, but the land.
And now you have to.
They weren't parcels before he built the road. But that's history.
Please excuse me.
I wasn't born yet.
Bond Street. You were born?
I didn't mean to make you feel bad there,
yeah.
But.
Well, I was only
just
four.
Just for perspective.
Ready for sea level rise.
Yeah. Well, that's what I said when Harry showed you the text, and I told that guy, water comes out of that pipe. It's not over the boat. So
can we act on the first?
The second. The 1981?
The 1981?
Nika's not here.
Hmm?
And Nika's not here now.
Oh.
I don't even understand why, if he can get another one that references this, the correct property, what this has to do.
Well, this is on the prop, both of the, they need closure on both. They need compliance on both.
Yeah, I just think the attorney made a mistake.
How long
yeah.
have you owned the property? And it didn't come up 19 years ago. No, but I mean when you bought the house, it didn't show up in a record search.
Nobody else that sold Gavin Circle has had this come up. It's only attached to yours. Deeper than the others.
Yeah.
You could pass three and then not pass the four.
I don't see granite bounds in that original one.
I bet in the subsequent one.
Subsequent one either.
Pardon me?
No. No granite bounds.
So I'd be reluctant to ask for granite bounds.
We can't. We have no authority to do that.
Right. So
yeah.
I'd be doing that.
I don't know that they make sense. Well, we put them in the middle of the lawn, right?
Do you have another one?
I think that's...
They're off and off.
I just brought in the one for 580.
Yeah.
Is that...
Seems so.
That's for the porch. And it talks about the drainage pipe that you saw off the driveway. Well, this is done in 2009, so it's got everything. I think you're talking about the other one, the 1981-2.
So can we handle one at a time?
Let's do the 1981-2.
That was for the street crossing. That was for the street crossing as described in 11, drainage ditch profile.
Well, it does apply to lot 3, 4, 8, and 9, and we don't know if this property is one of those lots.
It's not. It's on Pearl Street, isn't it?
Well,
no.
Since it is attached to this deed, let's presume that it is attached to this property. Okay. Exactly. We don't know exactly which lot it used to be, but it must have been one of those.
Is there an aspect that's not complying that we have concerns that it's not complying? I would agree with you.
I don't have any issues with. I have no problem issuing a certificate of compliance for 1981-2.
Do I hear a motion?
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Look at number 19B.
The applicant shall convey to the Reading.
Right. Do we know that lot A has been conveyed?
This isn't the deed for lot A.
No, it's not, but it says if we assume that this old condition applies to the property.
Chuck, can you select that lot?
Which is this lot A right here?
Yeah, tell us who the owner is.
No.
Maybe it was the town's and it was purchased by Pearl Street?
I don't want it. Isn't that coming from the assessors?
What do you want me to do? You want me to go to the property card?
Yeah.
But so it's right there, right?
Yeah. Sale price one.
Oh, but we don't know what the address of lot A is.
When was the purchase date?
1986.
Sales, go to the sales.
Sale date 1986. Huh. Land use code at the sale. We're going deep down the rabbit hole tonight, you
guys.
Well, I think...
Jamie, would we want this land if it were today?
You betcha.
Yeah, we would.
Why wouldn't we want it?
What?
Why would
we sell it?
Somebody's paying
taxes. It's part of Fair Meadow.
Is it?
I mean, that's what it's bumping into.
I mean,
it's part of Fair Meadow. Downtown Forest. That's Pearl Street.
Yeah, it is.
If it's...
That's Town Forest.
Is it a green Fair Meadow?
Yes.
Yeah, this is Long Meadow Cemetery, Longwood.
Well,
wait a minute. No, Bear Meadow is off. Bear Meadow.
Yeah.
Bear Meadow is off Pearl Street. So you see the little driveway for the parking lot for off the northern.
Yeah.
Don't move the map. I'm getting
there
nauseous.
Is. No, up.
Yeah, you see it?
Right there. Oop.
Here's the
right there, right there.
Yeah, so it's deep
in. This is the cemetery.
Mm-hmm.
So is Lot A part of Bear Meadow?
Well, it's contiguous to us.
It's contiguous. It is contiguous to Town Forest.
It's not the Town Forest.
Conservation.
That side of that area is not called Town Forest?
No.
Only the left side of 28?
Town Forest is the other side of town.
Yeah, Town Forest is
town
always
forest.
That.
Oh, okay. I've always used that. Full interest in other... less than fee interest in the portion of the land situated.
What's the other order of conditions you just brought up?
That was for the porch and that was for the drainage off the driveway.
New driveway, porch. When was all that work done?
Porch with a roof, the front of the house, same elevation, extends over existing concrete wall, provides slow level, porch at the front of the house.
Chuck, isn't there a layer in our GPS that says 10 on land?
I am not let's see what's going on here. It's not something I use a lot.
Open space.
Let's try that.
Yes. The house on the corner of Gavin and Franklin, is that an older house? Was that existing?
That was existing.
So
it's actually the address is French.
So 30 Gavin is the first one in, right? So that would be lot one of the subdivision, right? Wouldn't it? You always stop to the left and go around.
Gavin is the third one in.
Oh, it's the third one.
Yes, there
by
the stream.
Okay, so it'd be lot three. It'd be lot three, so it's on this order condition. If you build a new subdivision, you start on the left, you then bring around to the right. So that's would be lot three on a subdivision plan.
So this applies.
So I would say this applies. But I think a lot of stuff happened or didn't happen as far as this 19 is concerned. I'm prepared to just give you a heads up.
system compliance that is going to be happening.
I think Jamie's point is, this document says if we release this order of conditions, we lose our ability to enforce the conveyance of Lot A.
At this point in time, do you know where to take to enforce the conveyance of that? We don't know what happened to that. Somebody might own it.
Well, apparently, Mr. Harper owns it.
Yeah.
So
it's a going to force somebody
Mr.
To
Harper.
Mr. Harper.
It's going to be lawsuits for 20 years.
And I don't know that we.
So the 10 never got it.
Well, we don't
potentially.
Know.
Maybe they got it, and
well,
maybe
they
sold
it
back.
Sold in 1986,
yeah.
And this
no,
was
they
1981.
Didn't,
they didn't
sell conflict plan, I take that.
Then they
never
got
it. In 1986? Were you?
No, I mean, you can't do that under state law.
Could you do it in 1986?
No.
No.
A lot of the
well,
a lot of the conservation land
I was born
is back from the 50s.
But is that true? If we issue a certificate of compliance on this older order, there's no recourse to follow up about this Lot A matter?
I don't know that for certain, but I would.
Well, I don't either.
So.
Chuck, can we issue certificates for
a lot?
A lot.
Yep.
So can't we just issue it for this lot? And if
which
it's
lot is it?
For the lot, for the lot located at current, yeah.
Currently
Gavin Circle.
Yes.
And then those other lot owners could be on the hook for Lot A.
Absolutely.
And instead of dividing it among 20 properties.
Well, it's just musical chairs. Last one out has to buy a Lot A for us.
Right.
Fine. But I just hope someday if this commission puts a constriction on our order conditions, another conservation commission in 20 years ignores them and says, oh, they're full of crap.
I hope
those
so.
Those guys back in
yeah.
2016, they're all dead.
Okay, do I have a motion?
To issue a partial.
Certificate of compliance.
Well, partial, I don't think she can sell the property.
Four.
For 30 Gavin Circle.
30 Gavin Circle.
Has to be full. She can just sell the property.
No, we can.
They have partials in condos all the time. They're doing that. I don't think it'll be an issue.
I make that motion.
Well,
think it will be an issue. If it comes back to me, I don't know. But we are issuing partial order of conditions for condos.
Order of conditions?
Well, you know what I'm talking about.
Certificate
of compliance.
Yeah.
Issuing a partial
certificate of compliance for condos.
Does not, in the attorney's eyes,
despise
people buying this house. They're always going to say,
"No,
someone's still responsible for that. Who's going to get the fault?"
Yeah.
Well.
Who's going to be responsible for getting a fault?
Thank you, but maybe you should ask town council because you know I understand what you guys are saying, but I'm not a lawyer either, so.
No, I know the convey. I do it a lot. I know this lawyer is going to say this is his client's not going to be responsible for obtaining a false certificate of compliance at some point in the future.
Whose client? On 30?
The bank's lawyer.
The
purchaser's.
The
buyer's bank.
He's out of the mix as far as I know how those things go.
No,
he's not. He can't get the mortgage unless he has
a
certificate of
compliance. The partial is a full certificate of compliance on his lot. That's how it's written.
Well, this would be a full.
It's not. It's a partial because there's other lots that aren't being released.
Then it's a full compliance for 30 Galvin Circle.
That's right.
Isn't
exactly.
That
that's exactly what we're doing.
30 is in full compliance.
Okay, that's right. That's fine.
Okay.
30 Galvin. No.
For
it's
this
an English
order,
page,
left,
you
know. So the word partial is not going to be on this.
Partial is because it's multiple lots.
Right.
It does say partial. It says partial on it.
But it won't on
but it one. But it says that 30 Gavin Circle is completely I don't know what the wording is, but it's met the criteria of the Conservation Commission. We release it entirely.
So I made
this
a motion.
This is only for the 81.
Yes. And I would second that motion.
All those in favor?
Thank you for bringing an interesting problem.
Now we have another
now we
one.
Have the
yes,
other
we have
one.
A second one.
Let's sign it.
To
the language is right on the second page. Sign it, not forget about that. I didn't know if you were going to do a full or partial.
So regarding the matter of plantings, you know, at this point, for the sake of expediency and, you know, given what the property owner's schedule is for this property, I think some sort of seed could fit the bill. Well, it's low-lying. It's not a steep slope going to the wetland. It's not.
It's less. You're trying to move tomorrow. When it.
That's exactly where the moving van's parking.
When
well,
but
when
that's
trans-
what we don't
when
want,
are you
right?
planning to do the closing? Tomorrow? Friday morning.
Yeah.
It did look stable.
There's a lot of stone in it.
A lot of stone. It didn't look like erosion was easy to move.
And it was that only that one spot where the drainage was, because the relish had a little bit of mulch still
everything,
left on it.
Everything else was mulch. I thought everything else was mulch. It was just this area coming off the driveway. And so my only concern with is, and there was a drainage pipe. This is why we noticed the drainage pipe.
Yeah.
Is if water sheet flows coming off the driveway, that's exactly where it's going to. It's going to this area where it's just dirt. There's nothing to protect it. There's nothing to stop it from going in.
Did you say that weeds come up through there every summer, spring? They come up right there, all the way along the driveway there. They come over into the grass.
Oh, it grows in.
As it grows in.
Yeah, those weeds come up every year.
The reeds.
The reeds.
Phragmites.
The phragmites.
So.
That was.
excuse me, but this is, I think, what we just voted on. And it says partial certification. It is hereby certified that only the following portions of work regulated by the above referenced order of conditions have been satisfied. The project areas were subject to this partial certificate that have been completed and are released from this order are, and then it's blank.
Right. You told me to write that in tonight. That'll be written in on this.
Let's write it in now and make sure we're comfortable with it, if you don't mind.
So it's just 30 Gavin Circle.
Yeah.
That's all you can write, 30
That's
Gavin Circle.
All activities pertaining to 30 Gavin Circle.
That's what I'll write. So you're releasing the entire lot.
Yeah.
And, okay. I mean, you could do that. That lot has certain things that are still needed to be accomplished before we give them a full certificate, but I don't think you'd ever want to use it that way. So it is written with a little bit of wiggle room.
I mean, if we sign this, how are you going to write it in?
I won't look when I... Oh, actually, you know, I can write it in right now, and you guys can sign it, and I'll bring up... You can handwrite it in there, too.
That's what he's doing.
It's fine.
Because the project areas of work, the project areas or work subject to this partial certificate that have been completed and are released from the order are 30 Gallon Circle, which is the area.
It's Gavin?
Gavin.
Yes.
Sorry. G-A-V.
I-N. Is there another one we need to sign?
Yeah.
Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to issue a certificate of compliance for 270-0580.
Do I hear a second?
Chelsea.
I will second that. All right. All those in favor? Abstained? Denied. the sake of plantings. We just, but went through anyway. So we're all set.
Are you going to come in tomorrow and pick that up? Anytime after 10 would be great. I could even drive it to your house. It's been so painful. That's where I'm at, yep. Okay, great.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for staying.
Thank you.
Did you abstain?
You're all set. Thank you.
Thank
all
you.
Right.
Cedar Swamp. Is this continued?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Certificates of compliance for 3 pieces of Mariano Drive, 92 Sanborn Lane. Okay. We did have a site visit. And, oh yeah, you have to abstain.
What's,
which one are we on?
We're not on Hopkins?
Hopkins?
No.
Oh, shoot.
We can skip ahead,
that's fine.
Sign.
It doesn't matter. He's
yeah, it's all the same.
Okay. You don't mind if we mix them up, huh? All right.
So what's your question? Or what didn't you?
Which spot are we going to talk about?
We're going to talk about the bocce court, which is
lot two.
That looked pretty good. The erosion on that left-hand side as you're walking down towards the bocce court away from the drive didn't look bad. It was bad the first few times we saw it. And there was a lot of material that had been removed out of the wetland as requested.
Including a jail door.
Well, that could have been the other place. I don't know.
We don't know what was taken.
Oh, we're doing one lot at a time.
Yes,
yeah,
we are.
Gotta keep it clean.
I thought it was three and one. Darn it.
We didn't learn anything from the last matter. Keep it straight.
I guess.
Not all of it was ripped out, but a lot of it was cut. If you take all of it out, you really destabilize the slope. It's reinforcing it.
Chuck was showing me pictures yesterday.
Yeah. All those concrete blocks with the ends
did you show Jamie?
Were they still there?
They're still there.
The concrete with the pipes were still there on the side, yeah.
Piled on top.
So, time out. Isn't that lot three?
That is
yeah,
lot
we're going to stick with lot,
well, lot
two.
Two.
Lot two.
Let's just talk lot two. That's good.
Lot two.
That's the bocce court.
Mm-hmm.
That's the bocce court one.
The only issue there was the erosion, right?
There was trash.
There was some fencing that was going to be removed there. There was some trash in that one that was going
to
be removed.
It appeared to be removed.
Yeah. We did observe, not to get to lot three, but there were some erosion concerns associated with lot three. It seemed like it was close to moving over to lot two, but from what I saw, and Amy, you may concur, it seemed like there's a hump. I don't really have too much concerns with erosion, based at the interface of lot three and lot two right there. There were some small signs, but nothing that would seem like it would get into the wetlands.
It's true. There was a, just beyond where the erosion was like a mound, like a berm. So it wasn't going anywhere. It was bare soil.
Yeah.
It was going to sit there.
At the top of slope or at the bottom of slope?
The bottom of slope.
At the bottom of slope. I missed that.
And then on the side of the house on lot three? Is there still
we're on to lot three? Oh, we're only talking lot two now.
Oh, lot two. Okay.
It's between, where's the line?
It's just it's parallel. It's beyond everything, really.
So
it's kinda
like
at the
right
corner
here.
Of the house.
Right.
But
here.
It's in the wetlands.
No, it was along where the hay bales were.
Oh, okay.
It's exactly
it's where the
reason
hay
why
were.
It's bare, because the hay bales were there.
Yeah. So.
And it's above the wetlands because it's where that pile of stuff is.
Mm-hmm.
It's flatter down as you walk further down past the other side of the house.
So the slope came down, there were hay bales, there's this little hump, and then you go down another slope.
That's probably not on here.
And so, looks like the hay bales were removed, maybe, you know, it just didn't fill in, but it didn't look like it could go anywhere. This is in lot two. Extended about 10 feet in. I personally didn't have any concerns with it.
It was something you noticed, but not something you think that needs to be addressed.
Correct.
Okay.
Because it's impossible to erode. It's bare soil. I mean, if you said, look, I want grass established on this before I close out, then it's all about just having it completely covered with grass.
What size surface area?
We're talking 2.5 feet by 15 feet.
Okay. All right. So it's like a shelf.
Yeah, it's like where the hay bales were
mm-hmm.
for 15 feet.
Well, plus in this area, we're going to have volunteer vegetation anyway.
And it's likely to be frag or Japanese knotweed.
Japanese knotweed.
Because that's what's right there anyways.
Yeah. Okay. Any other outstanding issues on to close out lot two? What about the street, Chuck? You were going
that's
to...
That's a different...
Street's different?
That's a different one. Yeah. That's a different piece.
Okay, but it does drain. But it does drain to this lot, mm-hmm. you know, so...
The drain on the street, that's the one we were checking out and looking at, and it looked... You know, that's when we said, hey, it looks like something's blocking that. Those storm drains are all open now. There's nothing coming out the other side. Or hardly anything. I looked at it several times.
Okay.
Because usually there's a trace, and usually you get that first flush of sediment, and that wasn't even there.
Okay. I move we issue a certificate of compliance for lot two.
Second it?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Vote or not?
No,
he cannot.
He can't vote.
He's recused.
He's recused himself,
yeah.
So he's
yep.
officially
he's
not.
He's not abstaining.
He's recused, so okay.
Yes.
Just procedurally asking. Okay, lot three, which is the yellow house, right? And
well, the only thing in lot three that's in our jurisdiction is that lower half of that cul-de-sac. I'm not even sure it includes the tree. So, the tree in the center of the cul-de-sac.
Okay.
So you're really talking about one storm drain and some pavement and curbing and, of course, the street trees.
I'm sorry. Lot three?
Lot three is going to be the roadway, right? Oh, am I...
Lot
that's
three
lot.
Is the yellow house.
There's a road. There's a separate roadway.
There's
one.
A separate roadway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a separate roadway lot.
Non-botchical. That's how I remember.
So this lot is currently owned by Mr. Lewenick. Okay. And what were the outstanding issues for lot three?
There
was debris in the wetlands, which you pulled out as part of what. That was what else?
I have to say, I think other than policing the area for trash, which looked pretty good on Tuesday night, I don't think that these guys could have pulled out anything because they pulled out everything they could, and then I told them to pull out even more. So we got a lot of stuff. They got a lot of stuff, and they were told to go back and get more. And with those two, that procedure, it worked out great. So I wouldn't think that anything else. You know, every year something's going to get, you know, going to come up from the swamp somewhere, and you know, and that's what happens. They just appear. But right now, all the metal's out, and all the stuff that can be taken out of there looks pretty good. Police it with the trash. I still think there might be some more construction debris out there, but that's nothing to hold this up on. But there's a right where one of the granite bounds are. Jamie will remember this because I think you tripped exactly in that spot. That erosion area has gotten a little worse and eaten its way up the hill a bit, in my opinion. And the erosion on the far side of the house is getting a little bit deeper, so it hasn't been corrected, and the grass is pretty sparse, so.
I would concur, I saw, well, I shouldn't say, I didn't see the other side of the house when we went Tuesday, I didn't.
That's the picture I showed you.
Okay.
So I have a picture, it's on my phone.
I have seen it in the past.
Yeah, I saw it previously, I haven't seen it recently, but I would concur at least with the area between there.
Yep.
Mr. Lelenic, redid his lawn for some reason, I don't know why after I left, otherwise it would've grown in more, so he's kind of responsible for his lawn now, he did after I left, but I talked to him the other day, and asked him his intentions, and he said, I'm gonna turn my spring clothes on for a life, fix my lawn, I said, I don't know. So I said, well, can I fix a couple of spots that the board's worried about? He said, if you can do something, go ahead and do it. So I was kind of waiting for him to do it, and if he's not doing it, then you know, I'll go out there with a couple of wheelbarrows and cover that over and throw some tea on.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we really need to, we really do need to repair that area that's just off the edge of lawn.
Yeah, I know
where the hay bales. It's pretty, it's like a little gully.
Yeah.
So we will continue this one until, you know, you establish some seed.
Probably, yeah, until when you left.
Yep.
I'll get it.
Yep. Okay.
There's one issue I'd like to bring out. When we wrote the bylaw, rewrote the bylaws and also rewrote the regulations. We formed an ad hoc committee to draft and promulgate those regulations and bylaw changes. And we were told in no uncertain terms by town council that anybody on that ad hoc committee writing those regulations was precluded from coming before those boards for anything in compliance with the regulations they helped write. So,
say that
you following
again.
Me?
No.
Say that again. You're saying somebody who works on the ad hoc committee that modifies the regulations has no right to apply for any matter before us pertaining to those regulations.
That's exactly right. It
What's
seems,
the reason for that?
It seems a little bit extreme, but town council was emphatic, as was our town clerk.
Why is that an ethics violation?
It's a conflict of interest violation.
So, how is it a conflict of interest when?
Where are you going with this?
When something
I'm not following this.
Are you follow that part of it though, right?
Not really. I hear what you're saying, but
well,
I don't.
What they're saying is, if you cannot write the regulations and then submit an application under those regulations if you've written them. That's a conflict of interest.
That was a former administration, though?
A former administration?
Well,
no,
this was
4 years ago.
Oh.
It was a former town council, but.
Yeah.
Well, so
I don't know if that means anything, but I would like that opinion
to
be.
Would they feel the same way now? I mean, it seems such a silly.
Did you?
It doesn't seem to make sense to me.
Right, those
Once
regs
the laws
well,
changed.
If I'll tell you exactly what happened. We asked Brad Latham to be on the committee to help us revise the regulations. And we asked Jack Sullivan.
Gotcha.
And we
I
asked
hear
a
wait,
couple
see
of others. And they said, well, we are quite reluctant because historically
right.
the Commonwealth has ruled if you're on one of those committees, then you cannot appear before those committees. And so we took the town council and said, they're absolutely right.
So
that's
in a town reg matter, not a state reg matter.
Well, it's part of the state
I mean,
conflict of interest, but it's administered by the
state. So it would be the same. So I see those two people as they would benefit if they really got the upper hand on understanding, because they're at these meetings a lot, but a homeowner wouldn't.
We asked that question.
Okay.
Bill Heck and I asked that question. They said it applies to a homeowner also.
Can
oh,
I ask
really?
How this pertains
so,
to lot
yeah,
three?
How does any regulation
yeah.
get written?
So we had to explain to everybody on that ad hoc committee that if you have wetlands on your land, you cannot apply if you've been on this ad hoc committee. So there was some concern there, but that's what we did. So this is where I'm going with this. And I don't know, because I'm not a lawyer,
But I think there's enough concern we need to check. If we issue an ANRAD, that is somewhat equivalent to regulation because it specifies what's, what resources are there. So if we issue an ANRAD, then somebody comes and proposes a development on that land with an ANRAD, and they voted on that ANRAD, they might, that might be a conflict of interest, and they would not be allowed to propose a development on that land if they participated in the ANRAD development.
What? Well, wait a minute.
Follow me?
Yeah, I follow you, and
perhaps,
I don't disagree.
But I'm going to ask
and
again.
So I think we need to check. I'm not saying.
So
what,
is,
we,
what does this
we,
have to do with Lot 3 right now and this particular?
It doesn't have anything to do with Lot 3, but we're looking at two or three ANRADs.
Correct, right.
And if somebody on this board votes on that ANRAD and then shows up before us with that application to
conflict
develop that land, it could be a conflict of interest, and that whole ANRAD could be thrown out.
So, Jamie, let me ask you a question. Go ahead.
The only thing I would say is I would agree with you only if we had only four votes on that ANRAD. I would, if there was enough to, you know, to disqualify that vote, then I would disagree.
At least in our previous example, that did not matter because the ad hoc committee didn't even vote. They just influenced the development of the regulation. So somebody sitting in this room on the board could influence that ANRAD. I'm just saying we should check, and it'd be better to check now.
I have a question just before you do that. We were told when the certain gentleman on our committee came here that it wasn't up to the committee to tell him when he needs to recuse himself or not. It's his own decision. So if we brought that forward, if someone brought
who
in
told,
and
who told you that?
I called the Ethics Commission.
I did as well, and I was told that it's more financial. If there's any way that I see a path to benefiting financially from any vote that I may or may not take on this committee, then I have to accuse myself.
Well, I think we're exactly talking about that.
Well, I think
so,
that could fall within.
Yeah, so getting back to what I was saying, wouldn't it be up to Al? I mean, unless
right.
we wanted to file
complaint,
a grievance or something like that, what are we supposed to do?
I think we need to check the town council and going through Bob or Jean and ask that question.
Regarding which specific matter before us, this
are
lot?
You just
Lot 3, or
say,
are we talking?
I think he's
talking
about.
There,
he's just talking about just
we know
hypothetically
a lot
in the future.
Of, controversy over these ANRADs that we're talking about with the neighbors.
Right. Correct.
Yeah.
Let's say we issue that ANRAD, and
yep.
then a member of the commission comes back with a development plan to develop that land. Mm-hmm. The citizen can say, "Wait a minute! You're the one that approved that ANRAD. Now you're coming back and you're going to develop that property. That's
yep.
a clear conflict of interest."
And I would agree.
Yeah.
So I think we just need to check, and then Al might want to recluse himself from voting or participating in those ANRAD discussions. If that's the case, or he might be precluded from developing those, for proposing on those lands.
And that would be in perpetuity?
Well, for those lands? Oh, I don't know. I don't know. But
well,
that's
ANRAD
the, I
would only be for 3 years.
Ask.
Right?
I'm sorry, what?
The plans only
for ANRAD
3.
Only for 3 years.
So,
but wouldn't it?
Past plans influence, you know, a future.
I just think
development.
We should ask because better to ask before it happens. If we have the citizens standing up here hollering at us, it would be nice to say, yes, we checked with town council, ethics committee, they said there was no problem.
Well,
I'm
not sure it's the responsibility of the commission.
I agree with Chuck that it's the applicants or the commission members' responsibility. I remember reading that as well, to decide whether they want to recuse themselves or not. And all the responsibility for that goes to the member.
Well, that's
right.
on, right. I still would feel more comfortable if we brought this up and asked.
Okay, I mean,
if you'd like to discuss
question.
It, if
yeah.
you'd like to look into it, I have no objection.
Well, we have to go through the town hierarchy.
Well, you got me thinking now, so.
No, you know what,
yeah.
It's a good question, and, you know, better to know it early on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have no issues with that. I mean, anything that I'm interested in developing, then I'm usually involved in the ANRAD process in the beginning, and if that was the case in Reading, then I would recuse myself in the beginning during the ANRAD process.
That's,
yes. So, Jamie, it's really only a question if the situation that you brought up were going to arise. Again, I think it's still up to Al, though, to choose.
When the sticking point is what I'm sitting thinking. So some of the ANRADs that have been coming before the board as of today,
right,
and as of when I'm voting on them, I have absolutely nothing to do with.
But in the future,
2 years from now, someone might come to me and say, hey, Al,
yeah,
this, and I might say, well, yeah, maybe I do want to purchase that.
Well, then
that's where things
that's,
get.
And that's
yeah.
when you have to decide if you
that's
are conflicted.
Well,
right.
I've
he might have
I've
to decide, but think of the pressure we'd be under from the citizens.
Well.
No, I think at that time, it's up to the commission, that commissioner to go and ask the question.
Yeah.
That's right. I would document it myself, and I would appear before the board saying, hey, I voted on this ANRAD 2 years ago. I spoke to town council. I spoke to this attorney. I have 3 legal opinions. I don't think this is an issue.
Yes.
Well, let me just say the ethics rules are not only a potential conflict of interest, but appearance of potential conflict of interest. So even if you have no intention, you know what I mean? If somebody could reasonably perceive that there was some vested gain, then you'd have to. Ethics rules do say
you're. But
you
we're
need
still
to
jumping the gun.
Yourself.
There's no
right.
vested.
I think
no
I think we're talking
until,
a lot of hypothetical
yeah.
right
some,
now.
I think that somebody is not the board. That's an aggrieved party somewhere.
Well,
yes.
I think that's a good question to ask.
Yeah.
And I think it also
that's all
means.
I'm suggesting. I'm not trying to rule on it. I just.
Can't.
Am picturing.
Yeah, no, I think
myself
it's,
or a future
yeah.
commissioner being beat up by the citizens.
But it's yeah, but it's but again, we can't force anybody to recuse themselves.
No, but it was a good
but
to bring up.
It is good
I
to
think
bring
it,
up.
It really highlighted the situation, and
okay.
I think everyone knows right now, and we'll get some opinions on this.
So
okay.
now you got me wondering if. If a tree committee.
Can we talk about
yeah.
the tree committee?
Well,
so
exactly.
It's on the agenda.
Creates a rule about trees. Can you cut down a tree?
I'm within 100 feet of you. Can I take
it.
Down a tree? I mean, that's.
We'll get to that in a minute.
Okay.
Oh.
That's a policy.
Because I thought the same thing when we were having that conversation.
Oh,
that's where I thought
you
were going with this.
This
right.
way, that's the only ad hoc
and
committee
I think,
that I was thinking
I think
thinking
Becky's going to be bidding on that Wise Potato truck.
Just one
so.
Second, Becky.
She likes
one
that
second.
Truck.
Well, just tell me, what is the question as you see it posed to the town council?
What is the potential for conflict if a board member votes on a regulation or an ANRAD and then subsequently comes back with an application.
Did
that
he? Did that person? Did that person get an advantage, an unfair advantage?
So, I mean, it goes sit and forget about what we just said for us. Can if Al's part of the ad hoc committee for trees, can he never take down a tree within 100 feet of a wetland?
I think if it's a policy, it's okay. It's a regulation. Or an ANRAD, I'm equating to a regulation.
If Al cuts down a tree in the forest, and nobody hears
join
it.
Join the ear.
Does he go to jail?
So you have to supply his own jail door.
He has one.
Well,
don't give Chuck the
I
ammo.
I think what was the biggest concern that you said is I think that Jack Sullivan did it. I, you know, in my opinion, that a lawyer has to be very careful, and I wouldn't be surprised if he went above and beyond what most people need to do. But when Jack says you got to be careful. It really makes it more.
I would see why
home.
You wouldn't be on. Yeah, I wouldn't. I wouldn't. Yeah, that's a conflict. Definitely.
Well, I imagine they'd have a hard time finding people that are willing to sit on that board. under those circumstances.
Yeah.
We did. What we found, what we found was current members, past members, and then I think we had one other person, I can't remember who it is now, who wasn't a current or past member. And, but then what we did, we called Brad Latham, Jack Sullivan, and a number of other people before the ad hoc committee to answer questions, specify their opinion.
But that's on the second.
So we involved them, but they didn't, they weren't back. They weren't in a decision-making process.
But they're still influencing the decision.
Yes, but we also called environmental advocacy groups. We wanted to hear from all sides.
Okay. Mariano Drive, roadway. 270-0627. Did we discuss this? Chuck, you said.
I said, I did. So let me pick up where I left off. I think that the bones are there, and I you don't know if anything, all these, well, it has the curbing, and it has the, is it called a binder, but it doesn't have the top coat. So it's not completely finished. I don't know if that matters to anyone, but I wanted to bring that up. And the trees that are in the buffer zone now, even though they're street trees, they haven't you know, been planted for a full year yet. So I don't know if they're going to survive. So that's the only thing I would bring up to you people, and you can take it from there.
Is there some contingency if they don't survive? Do they?
Yes.
Yeah, I think they're street trees.
Both
yeah.
Both of those conditions are currently under bond with engineering. There's I think my balance is $38,000 for asphalt and trees.
But same gentleman, we asked. This is why we always carry our own bond. I think we have one on this project too, right?
Yeah.
So engineering won't hold any money for us. So I'm not sure they're going to hold any money for trees. Do they do that for street trees?
Trees are on my engineering bond.
Okay.
They're a line item on my bond. And I have to get signed off by Bob.
Did you get that one over at Marianne? What's your other place? Bethune? Yeah.
Yep.
That one's in. Not the one in the wetlands, one out by the street.
Yes.
Okay.
We don't usually issue a certificate of compliance to a TAM paving project until the final coat's in.
They don't.
They put a final coat down right away.
Well, the town paving projects are under under a general permit, or we've been doing RDAs for the town.
We'll think of West Street.
Right, yeah, that wouldn't, until it was done, you wouldn't get a final permit.
I can't remember what we do on other developments.
It doesn't seem like it would really.
Yeah, well, if you don't put the top coat down.
It's.
But that's bonded with the engineering.
So, what does it do to us? It does nothing.
Yeah.
Because actually, you're getting more leachate off the new coat.
There's a lip.
Yeah.
Water.
And no water's going to go into the catch basin unless it's a huge storm.
Well,
it's also not going to go anywhere else.
Yeah, it's still going to drain to that location.
It's going to be a puddle.
Yeah, did anyone notice? Was there a lip on those storm drains?
Small.
Then I think the town, you know,
and how long
I don't
have
think
the trees
engineering department's going to let them get away with.
How long have the
trees
been,
not set the right
been planted? How long have.
Six months?
Just
under 2 years.
Yeah.
Those trees.
I thought you did it last year, because that's when I was asking you about Bethune.
Yeah, but I did it last spring.
Yeah. Was it spring?
Over a year, I think.
I would say it was like a year or less. Yeah, so. They looked healthy.
My opinion is they've been in there for a year, they look healthy. And they're in a line item under the engineering bond. I don't see a reason to hold it up.
Unless there's a huge flood, and I don't know how erosion could happen down into the wetland from where that is. It seems like one of them was directed right into the guy's garage.
Can I also say this? If you did decide to vote to release the bond and approve it, on the roadway, and 2 months from now, it was a flood or a dead tree or something, I'll go fix it. You don't need my money to get me to do the right thing.
When do you plan to put down that final?
I just sold the last house there, so I was waiting for that. So I'm gonna, all three of those driveways in those homes, either top coat of asphalt and then the whole roadway. So I'm gonna do the whole thing at once. So I would say in about 6 weeks.
I move we issue a certificate of compliance for the roadway.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Oh, that's right.
61 Hopkins.
Well,
see, he's already going for an NRAD. I'm planted the seed.
Didn't we vote on this last
week? Yeah, I was supposed to prepare it, which I did. And it's an RDA, so I don't know.
We issued a negative, and we need to sign
it. But,
there was nothing else we needed, right?
No. I just didn't prepare it. There was something.
You brought it up, but the neighbor said, "Forget about it."
Oh, the
drainage yes.
toward that.
He said he was comfortable.
So my notes say shed removed, save blueberry bushes.
He's
going to move the blueberry bushes.
There's a driveway going in a certain area, and it was brought up.
Moving the three bushes.
It's going to direct water towards the.
Down.
I think it was, we went through all that.
You're going to remove the shed.
Threw everything against the lawn, nothing stuck, and you guys closed it out. Now we're supposed to prepare it. So really, not much discussion needs to happen.
So it's an RDA, so we don't need to close it. Let's just sign it.
I think the commissioner was cutting down trees in there.
Just waiting for it.
Yeah, he's on the tree committee. He's cutting trees down.
We haven't even met yet. He's not officially on the tree committee yet.
I got it now.
Is there a meeting scheduled?
Thursday?
Yes.
Did we get the notice in on time?
Yes.
Thursday is tomorrow.
Or so I was told.
Comedy of errors. Yeah.
It was tomorrow.
Issued yesterday.
Oh, tomorrow.
9 to 9:45 here.
You meant tomorrow?
Yeah. Yes, that's what the 28th is.
No, I'm joking.
That new web page, I can't find anything.
Everyone's complaining about it. I'm not even allowed to use it. Never mind. I go on it and people tell me stuff and I bring it to Julie, who is right up there with some of the good people that know how it works.
Chuck, wasn't she going to
it, you mean
join
just navigate?
Our site visits?
She was.
I think it was that bad.
She was, and I mentioned that. But. It just didn't work out. We actually came back a half hour late, so I don't know if this late on Tuesday night is going to work any time for Julie.
All right, sorry.
So we actually came back at 7:30.
Yeah.
So that's when I got back to town hall,
yeah.
And that wouldn't work for her.
Right.
So I'll invite her on each one until she shows up. She would just like to see how the process works. That's her only motivation.
Who's this?
The town Julie planner. Mercier. She's the town planner, the assistant town planner.
She's new?
Yes.
Jesse was the old one, right?
Jesse, yeah.
Is she gone?
Jesse's gone. She went to graduate school.
So who is, if she's the assistant town planner, who's the town planner?
Jean.
Oh.
Even though she's not a planner.
But she's the town assistant manager and the town planner.
Wanted to clarify that. All right. We got Hopkins done. We need to talk about Strawberry Lane.
What? Really?
Okay.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
Jamie remembers.
Wow.
Famous.
Oh, yeah.
It's still there.
Well, we got taken off the list.
It's filling in a little
bit.
It
did get taken off the list.
It
oh,
did.
Yes, it did. They
Why?
They went
they
out.
Filed the paperwork
they
we
went out and
asleep,
studied
and
it one spring.
Yeah, right. But anyway,
submitted paperwork.
It
They put glycophosphate in it.
That isn't on my agenda.
It isn't, because it came in at the very,
It's, we're get, we need to take it as an unexpected or anticipated item.
It's fine.
And we'll explain why, and it's always up to everyone, but if, I think Becky wants to tell you the story. I told Becky the story, and...
Go for it.
Well, it's... it's a continuance of an order of conditions, and it's about to expire, tomorrow. But even though you're supposed to file for a request to extend 30 days prior to the date of its expiration, if we don't sign it, we get to permit this all over again.
What is it?
It's a lot adjacent, but it's actually a little bit skewed from that. It's the last lot on Strawberry Lane.
Can Chuck
can
bring
we
it up?
Yeah,
on the
left or right?
Going
left.
In.
Chuck, can you bring it up on
the lady's
board?
big house?
Yeah.
Left.
Yeah,
right.
I want to see
it's
this.
It's across the street from the lady's big house?
Yeah.
That's where the vernal pool is.
No,
it's,
the vernal
it's
pool
the vernal pool's right in the back.
Has been, that house is developed there. And there's a little park and a little garden around it.
So Strawberry Lane
it's
is
edge of water.
Up here.
Yep, I gotcha. I know the area.
Yeah, can you call it up so I can see where it is in relation to...
So if I filibuster for 2 hours, Becky.
Right there.
But this, it
you're going to see you start talking gibberish
yeah.
if you filibuster
and
for 2 hours. That's not nice.
What's happened is the guy who's doing the construction work is working on other projects, so this is kind of language.
But
they
started
down,
it.
They cut down some large trees. They put in a wall.
Yeah, rock wall.
Rock wall. This is all open. There's no wetland here, but they put settlements there. And I didn't see much erosion.
So nothing drains this way?
No, I didn't know.
Nothing drains towards the pond?
No.
No, it all drains towards the pond.
Does it?
No, it doesn't. It was sloped.
No, it's going towards the pond.
Yeah, it's all draining. It's all draining exactly how the contours show.
235.
It's draining towards the pond. Is it likely that it's getting there?
241,
I don't know. There's a lot of stuff in the way of the stone wall.
Well, the one location where the erosion controls looked like they were getting a little beat up.
Yeah.
So where's
on
the old house on that map?
The old house is right here.
House.
Oh, yeah.
Just the old house in general.
Oh, gotcha.
So what's the question?
That is the applicant.
It's to extend the... order conditions. Was that another 2 years?
So there's
years?
The topo right there. So it's we got a 10-foot drop between the two solid black lines, and then it looks like it would come over, at least from this side.
I mean, the contours on this plan indicate that it would.
So
there
let me,
is that swale there. You
yeah.
see the swale on the...
I saw the swale on the plan.
Is
no,
it on the
it's not.
Yeah.
No.
It they
wasn't on
the...
That swale that's on the plan is not there.
It's not
yet.
There.
Well, they haven't
built the house yet.
So just to be clear, what does the site look like right now? They've cut trees. Have they dug foundation?
No. They put in a rock retaining wall.
They put in one wall and they've cut trees.
Back here, where there's no retaining wall indicated.
Actually, even though they got that off the list for vernal pools under our new regulations, it says it's vernal pool if it's either listed or qualified to be listed.
And the reason they got it delisted is because they went out there in the springtime and they said they didn't see the obligate species. And
was this Natural Heritage that went out there?
No. This was the applicant's consultant.
Who did they submit?
Who
to?
Went? They sent it to
Natural
Heritage, and I kept the letter. I still have. And Natural Heritage sent us a letter saying it's decertified. So this is the one decertified vernal pool in town.
You know, it works both ways, so that's yeah. I never heard of that happening before, but okay.
So that
has
blue pond, is that the vernal pool?
Yep.
Yeah.
That blue
the supposed.
Yep.
The
blue
alleged.
Pond.
That's the
supposed.
Famous blue pond. So there's pictures in vernal pool books of a pond with a with a dead tree across it, and then, and you know, 6 weeks later, it's all dry with the dead tree.
Right.
That's the place. That's the pond.
Yeah, it's a classic vernal pool.
It is a classic vernal pool. And I know people who who used to live on Walnut Street, which is near there,
correct,
who found salamanders running through their yard all the time.
Oh,
yeah.
They were running over to
yep.
the road.
That's too far. Other direction.
No.
Can you orient me to where Strawberry Hill Lane is?
Sure,
it's
kind of mixed up.
Near, you know, Walnut Street, right up from Sturgis Park, kind of.
Here's Old
South
Farm.
South Street.
Here's
well,
Walnut.
North South Street.
Show him Joshua.
Where's
Hopkins? Oh, it's Curtis. That's
our,
it. They lived on
our
Curtis.
Is Main Street down Summer.
There's
there.
Joshua.
Is Hopkins. And then we're going to go down Walnut.
Sturgis Park is in there somewhere.
It's right in
keep
there.
Keep going on Walnut.
And let me go past it.
There's
and
Sturgis
Park.
There's Sturgis Park.
Okay. Thank you.
This was the first place that Jamie and Bill brought me to someplace on Old Farm Road. And I was like, I can't figure out where we are. Because no road
right.
works correctly
right.
down there. They're all ending in different
right.
places.
Right.
I was so mixed up. I'm like, oh.
Right.
So,
the question
is, so the site is grubbed out, the trees that are supposed to be cut are stumped, but that's it?
Stumps still.
Your stumps are there. There's a retaining wall that's not on that plan. That's the furthest away in the corner of this lot.
Is the retaining wall in the buffer?
I'm not sure. I didn't
the
see
whole
that.
Site's in the buffer,
so
I think.
It
would be inside the 100.
But it's a loose stone
it'd be about 80 feet
retaining
away.
Wall that's beyond 35 feet. So.
When was the last time there was any construction activity on the site? Do we have any idea?
Two or 3 years ago. Is it two? Hold on.
But it wasn't like they stopped work on Friday.
No.
No, there hasn't
no.
been. There hasn't
if,
been work on the site for a while.
You've been busy
if
doing things for a while, huh?
If we did not approve a continuance of this, what would be the grounds?
No activity on the site.
We want to do this over again.
June 25th, 2015.
That was an old commission that.
Last time there's any
no, thanks.
2000. Well, it started
well,
on.
There's only two members here, right?
Right.
They say 13.
It was
2013.
Was when they started.
That's when they started the
I
process.
Didn't that one.
They recorded
yeah.
the order of conditions, and they gave me money for a bond. So we have a bond on this site, and they started in 2013 in June, and nothing really went beyond kind of a gravel construction entrance. And then they grubbed the site and they put up their erosion control. So I contact the owner and I asked her to correct or replace the erosion control that's out there right now, and she agreed to do that. And
the
we
owner
all,
is that woman, there used to be the woman in that mm-hmm. hedge cross
still
tree.
Is.
That's who it is. And
so at that point, I mean, this is past the 3-year window of wetland delineation, right? That a line on a plan is good for 3 years.
Well, that kind
of
works. That only works if you don't have, as long as you have an order of conditions to do the work, then it continues the wetland line. I mean, it's in effect. So everything's in effect.
But not if we sit here and say, well, it's been 3 years, that may not be the same wetland line, then it's not in effect.
Well, yeah, if you have some major problems with the site, this is what you're weighing. What do you have right now, which is probably a pretty solid order of conditions because it took so long and there's
mm.
people here that worked on it.
Mm.
And if you wanted to do that all again, what are you going to gain? I mean, what is going to be the marketable difference?
Chuck, there was in 2009 and 2010, and maybe Alan, you can help us out here, the governor issued a proclamation that any permits issued would not expire. was slowed down development progress. Is that still in effect?
The permit extension.
The permit extension.
Do you want to take this one, Al, or should I?
I don't know. So you take it.
Okay.
Because for a while there, we were extending
yeah,
it for 5 years,
extended.
Right?
So was it 2008, September 15th, 2008 to 2010? So the first one was 2 years. It was the Permit Extension Act. So anything in effect during that tolling period between 2008 and 2010 got an automatic extension of 2 years. That was the first thing that happened. Then in 2012, there was another one. And if you had a permit that was in effect from that first bit, you got another 2 years. So everyone started to look at it that if you had a permit that was in effect in 2008, September 2008, then you would add the 3 years for the permit that you would get automatically, and the 4 years from the two Permit Extension Acts, all right, so now we have 7 years. So most of these expire in 2016, and that's what's happening. So that we just did an extension at the last meeting, and we have another one right here in front of us, and people are kind of waking up. And that's also played into what we're doing here. I mean, since 2009, they had 7 years to never think about it, to contact the conservation office, and we didn't contact them because, you know, anyone can build a house in 7 years, I guess. I don't know what the thought was. But now she finds out through the process of her building permit expiring because of no work. And they came in for that, and we caught them through our view permit system. Or not caught them, but noticed it. And I gave her a call, and she understands that she needs to do this. And says she didn't know about 30 days, but in my opinion, that's really the only thing wrong with this order of conditions, that she didn't meet that 30-day period.
But she left the site unstabilized, hadn't done any work on it.
It has the erosion control on it.
Oh, it does.
And the ground, although doesn't have grass growing on it, it's a rocky soil, and it's really soft. There wasn't even
there was really just one location that we said, you know, it's probably been a while since someone's been here, it should be fixed up. I mean, but in general, the erosion controls were in good shape. There weren't signs of erosion. I mean, this is a gravelly site. There weren't signs of erosion. There
the
weren't
DEP signs
of.
So the last time work was actually done on this property was 2011?
I think 2 years. She said 2013 is when it started, and what they did probably only took about, I don't know, 6 months, 6 weeks?
It took 6 months.
6 weeks,
yeah. Something was wrong.
So it's been at least 2-3 years.
A little bit of history. When the developer, she and the developer, came in for the plan, the permit for this whole development, that lot was excluded from the development. That you cannot build on that lot. Because you can see it's big enough, but you can't build there
because of the vernal pool.
And she said, okay, I want my development anyway. So she turned in, and then she's been coming back ever since, trying to develop that same parcel.
But Jamie, isn't the vernal pool with the house next to it? Look, it's not part of this property.
But the vernal pool, the jurisdictional area around the vernal pool is 100 feet.
So it was that house always there?
Which one?
This one
here.
The
one on Walnut Street?
7-165.
No, the one, the one on Strawberry, that one.
It could have been, I can't say for sure. I know the one across the street's always been. That's a variable thing.
All right, that one. And that's where the vernal pool is.
2012 is the last one that was sold last. You can go to the property card.
Property card.
Sorry, when you talk to the property owner, did she say anything about plans?
Built
to
about 1998.
She says she's going to start anytime soon? Or?
No. She asked us to extend it for 3 years because she doesn't know when she's going to get this thing going.
How many times has it been extended?
We haven't extended it once, but she was fortunate to be part of that Permit Extension Act.
But it was part of that, but as a result of all that Permit Extension Act activity, how many extensions have already been given?
through that. She just ran the full 7 years.
I don't know if it was a considered, she went 7 years. So it's been 7 years since it's been issued.
Yeah.
It was issued in 2009.
Yeah.
Do I have that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Started work in 2013.
Is 15.
Yeah,
since
2009.
She applied in 2007 and it was denied because of the vernal pool. Then
right.
She got the vernal pool thing and then she came back in.
So can I,
is April 28th, 2009.
Is there a possibility to get that vernal pool back in?
If we have evidence that that vernal pool is functioning as a vernal pool, then under our new bylaws, jurisdictionally, it's a vernal pool.
Is there evidence that it was tampered with?
And yeah, that changes it.
Tampered with? I mean, it's
built?
In the
no,
middle
you
of
know,
a fairly developed area.
Yeah. You know, the nature of a vernal pool is that it's the place that all the creatures migrate towards for a short amount of time, and their real habitat is the upland. So it's really the critical time of protection is during the spring when all the mating is happening.
No,
so but if you destroy the upland habitat, there's no creatures to migrate to the vernal pool.
That
and that's essentially
pool.
What's happened in this area.
So it's not
well,
a vernal pool
know.
Because there's no animals living in it now?
Yeah, there
were right,
animals
that the upland
that we've had lying around. No.
You
don't
know.
No,
no. Well,
know.
We don't know. We don't,
you don't know
how you, they're...
So is there any thought... Is anyone suggesting that there was any physical changes to the pool?
Not
there's
really.
No way that they
well,
could... It's
there
off
were,
their property.
There were physical changes to the pool, not intentionally, but just because of the development.
The habitat
around
it.
Yeah.
Right.
But
not the pool, but the habitat around it.
Okay.
They've landscaped around it.
Yeah.
They've put...
Look at all the houses around it.
Yeah.
They put shrubs around it, little statuary here and there.
It's now surrounded by houses, whereas at some point it was not.
Right.
So, Chuck, we're not bound to, if we decided to extend this, we're not bound to extend it for 3 years, right?
The only requirement is that you can only extend it up to 3 years, so any other time period is fine. You could do 1 year.
Why 1 year?
I don't.
Well, I mean, I think.
1 year's not going to. She'll be back in 1 year and nothing will happen.
Well, then we won't give it to her, but the goal now, I think, is to get the place stable. Say, we'll give it, you got a year. Get it straightened out, finished, stable, and be in complete compliance with it.
Well, she said she would correct the silt fence that's kind of falling down.
Well, at this point, we don't want that. We want the whole thing done, right?
It's not going to happen.
Yeah, I don't think the expectation is that you issue a... what are we extending?
Order of conditions.
To do the work.
I mean, we don't issue an order of conditions with the expectation that nothing's going to get done. You expect that there's work going to be done.
Well, they do have extension permits for a reason, so...
Does she have to pay for an extension permit?
Whopping 25.
100?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Sounds to me like she has no plan to continue doing work. Why should we extend it?
Because it's the last day and she's requested to extend it and she's within
she
her right
she got caught
for
with
that
the building permit. It would
have
expired.
She's within her right to ask. But what's the reason to extend it? What's this commission's reason to extend it beyond? If there's no plan, if the we have indicated no plan of...
Reason to extend it so we don't have to go through another...
That's exactly why.
Notice of intent, more hearings, more site visits,
yep.
More time. That's the only reason I can think of to extend it.
But why would she be doing it? Why would you...
Do you feel like you would kind of end up at the same place after that was 3.5 months?
There's a chance that could be a vernal pool. It's only a chance.
There is a chance.
This is a building lot. No one's going to walk away from $400,000. Mm. If we say no, in 2 weeks, there's going to be another application.
I don't know about 2 weeks, but I would assume there's going to be another one, yeah.
There's going to be another application probably.
Yeah.
It's a good way to put it.
I don't know why she hadn't developed it.
No one's going to say, oh, yeah, the board said no, I guess forget about that.
But
But she's not gonna come back until she has a plan to develop it. I guess that's my point is.
She has a plan that's been approved. There's an order of conditions, there's a plan.
See, I was gonna approve the extension and then he's gonna go buy the lot tomorrow.
Hey, I've got some time, I can finish it up.
Well, I move we approve.
Wait a minute, let me
Let me just make the motion.
Well, discussion may not be over.
Well, you can make the motion. You actually are not supposed to discuss it until you've made a motion.
I move we extend the permit for 6 months.
A second.
Extreme weather conditions for the last 7 years?
Chuck, can I have one?
I'm going to stand by my motion.
She wasn't the original one.
Yeah. Chuck, these are your plans.
Isn't that a teacher at the high school?
D'Angelo? I don't know.
Her son-in-law was that attorney Mark down.
Is this?
Corner of Summer Ave and Moore. Mark.
And on this, it is a vernal pool?
It's not a vernal pool.
It used to be.
Yeah. The order of conditions is not a vernal pool.
That's right. It's not a vernal pool right now.
But it was in 2008.
So
it was historically, yes.
I'll say this because this is probably what would impact my vote. Is there a possibility that could turn into a vernal pool?
Evidence has shown itself in that location to prove historically 10 or more years ago that was a functioning vernal pool.
And what is the process to get it back into?
You have to document certain things. During
the breeding season.
During the breeding season, but it's coming upon us very quickly. And you have to get out there just at the right time.
And under our bylaws, or under our regulations, it doesn't have to be listed as a vernal pool. You just have to demonstrate that it meets the criteria to be classified.
Who qualifies to demonstrate that?
We do.
We go through the natural heritage checklist, the same process. And if the data is there to our satisfaction, then it's considered a vernal pool.
Okay, here's my question. We're talking private property again. Are we able to get out there and to document that?
That other resident has allowed us to do site visits through his property before.
Is it in the interest of this commission to have to document whether this is or isn't a vernal pool?
This guy here.
Wait, one at a time. I can't listen to two people at the same time. My kids are always doing that to me.
Is it in the interest of this commission to document whether this is or isn't a vernal pool?
Who's got a document?
This commission.
Will Finch would.
I don't know that I feel qualified to do that. I'm asking the question.
Will Finch would probably.
Yeah,
do it.
I think Will's also got.
He's working on that dog policy for Bear Meadow too, so he's got work to do.
Okay.
Who's Will?
Will Finch.
He was a former member.
He's on the trails committee.
Okay.
His wife is the GPS 10
GIS.
Coordinator, yeah.
GIS.
And GPS.
So, the work that has been done, is it in compliance with the order of conditions? I heard something about a retaining wall that wasn't planned.
Well,
it's a stone wall.
Could you just show me where on the plan that is? Is that in the...
Where the grating
where?
Is located in this area.
Oh, it's just down there?
Mm-hmm. It's 80 feet away from the resource.
Well...
It's within jurisdiction,
I would say
but it's
the only thing...
Away.
I think that could be... Well,
you know, I made the motion to extend the permit 6 months. In the letter, if that motion passes, it's been seconded, if it passes, in that letter, we could add to Ms. D'Angelo that we noticed that there is a feature on the ground that isn't currently in compliance with the order of conditions. You know, does she want, is there any additional activity that she intends to do on the site that is not in compliance with the order of conditions?
Is this the discussion time?
What are you going to get in six months?
I don't like this at all.
What's this 6 months thing going on?
What's 6 months
going
to give you? She can't...
She hasn't been able to in 7 years. I don't like this.
Yeah.
Like,
what do you don't like it?
I don't like extending it. I don't feel like the spirit of the conditions have even been remotely met. She wasn't up on her expiring permit. We've got a
make a motion.
Who's sandlot?
Who's paying attention to the erosion controls? Who's paying attention to? Nobody's paying attention
it's
to this
completely
site.
Completely uncontrolled.
If it was me, I'd be standing right there.
Right.
No, wait a minute. That was covered. So we had many conversations. So Mona's mother broke her something. I forgot what it was, and she said, I have her phone number here, and if she wants to come down, she said if she will come down and talk to you guys if I give her a call. But her mother fell or something like that. She has a broken rib or broken two ribs. She's like 90 plus years old.
That's the original developer of this thing. It's not,
yeah.
it's not her.
It's Mona's mother.
Yeah, that makes sense. She was an older woman. I know that.
So if you
don't want to extend it for 6 months, propose another motion.
Well,
so
we
got one
on
the floor already.
To Al's point and to Chuck's point, you know, does it make sense to extend it?
A week.
To the 11th. I know. Maybe not to 11th, so we're not doing this again, but a month so that she has the opportunity to come before us and explain.
I think if we did that and we instructed or asked Chuck to have a conversation with her and say, look, we extended it a month so you could come before us. I'm telling you from the meeting we had, if you come before us and you don't have a viable plan to develop this property, in all likelihood, you're not going to get extended again.
Can she put that together in a month, not being a developer?
Yes.
She's supposed to have a plan already.
That's the
idea.
She has a plan.
That's the point.
What plan is she going to devise?
This is the plan.
You gotta hold it.
Yeah.
I'd have a foundation in there in a week.
I just think you're making it so tough that it doesn't. Well, you should just deny it because to give her a month or 6 months doesn't make any sense.
Month doesn't give you anything.
No,
right.
What's the point?
6 months doesn't give you anything either.
No, you're
what
right.
What I'm saying is, give a month. And tell her to come here with a plan because she's going to develop the property.
Look, we can't play parlor games with the Wetlands Protection Act. You need to either deny it or
right.
a year
right.
to 2 years. 2 years seems reasonable for this. So you can't be like, can't. It's not supposed to be manipulated that way.
I mean, I'm not opposed to having, listening to what this person has to say.
Yeah, so I don't want to just, I don't disagree. We can't just play Harley games with this, but I'm under the impression that I would just, you know, not extend it, but I'm willing to have the applicant come in and tell us why we should. They should have that opportunity, and I understand they couldn't be here tonight, so this extension allows them to have that opportunity.
I think that's fair, too.
And Nico, will you accept a friendly motion to change it from 6 months to 1 month?
There can always be more motions, or we could vote on the standing one, however procedurally you guys want to proceed.
I make a motion.
I'm going to write this for a moment.
Well, there's already a motion on the floor we have to dispose of.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
So you want to call for a vote?
For what?
There's,
to
I mean,
rescind
no,
the first
to,
one?
No.
No,
to vote on
months.
The motion to extend the permit for 6 months that Jamie seconded.
Okay. All those in favor? All those opposed? All those abstained? Okay.
Okay. Now Mike, did you?
I make a motion to extend the. Do you have an?
It's 270-4547.
Order conditions 270-540-547, 1 month to. It would be, you know, I'm thinking to work to conservation, just in case something happens this next one. That would be May 25th, 2016.
I'll second.
I'd like to propose an amendment to your motion that, in addition, that we request that she come to the next Conservation Commission meeting and explain why the delays and what her plan is to move forward.
Second.
I have a question, though. Again, a procedural one. So we extend it, so then in a month, and she comes in with something reasonable. So then we would extend it again?
Well, we'd vote.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, if it were reasonable, we'd vote a second time.
I don't know.
Why not?
Vote for another extension. I mean, it's going to expire.
So our options are it expires in an hour and 34 minutes.
If we extend
literally.
It 3 years, and she was here.
Or we give her a month so we can have a constructive conversation.
She has to put her request in 30 days before the anniversary date, so.
But so she already hasn't done that. So
was it just a month we gave her?
If we were following that rule, she'd already be out.
We just gave her a month, so tomorrow she has to request
an
extension.
But if we were really following that rule, she would already fail to qualify for an extension.
Well, just because she didn't do it once doesn't mean she shouldn't do it twice. Check to say you got to write a letter. Or maybe email it to my office.
So that gives her enough time to do the extension this time.
It
gives puts in compliance with DEC.
Does this actually then, does this qualify as it?
Yeah.
Because she's
got
it. She has a letter.
Not for the next one. How does it qualify for that?
Okay, well, she just changes the date on this and then.
Bingo. Okay.
Oh, I'll write it in for her. Okay.
No, we need that.
So can I make
there's no date on this.
So
it's not dated.
It's not dated.
So I would make. We've already voted. No, have we voted?
No, we haven't voted.
I would make one other amendment that if we choose to extend a second time, she would have to. She would be required to do another $25.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. We can. Yep. We can choose at that time whether it can be. It should be waived.
Good thing we don't get paid by the
that's
hour.
That's messing with the.
Let's vote on the motion.
We have to vote on the amendment.
Vote on.
I move we.
Vote on the whole thing.
Yeah.
No, you vote on the amendment, and then you vote on the motion.
I move we approve Jamie's friendly amendment.
Second
to the motion.
What? Yeah, sorry, the amendment. You just called for the vote on the amendment.
You just seconded.
No, I didn't. And we didn't have seconded.
Well, it's our the amendment's already.
I think
been
we
seconded.
Call we call for
vote.
A vote.
All
we
right.
Just call for a
vote
on
the
amendment.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay.
Now we have to vote on the main motion. As amended.
Do I hear a second?
We already had a second.
All right. Those in favor? Opposed?
Whoa.
Okay.
Did we get a count?
Three to three.
No.
Four to three.
Four to three.
In favor? Uh-huh.
Right.
Woo. You, and you did not, they were against. So there were three.
Okay. So now, what next? Are we done with 14 Strawberry Hill Lane?
Yes,
yeah, we have to notify her that it's been extended for
a month
and that she has to appear before the Conservation Commission and explain.
Chuck, you'll have a conversation with you, right? How it happens when?
Yeah.
Yes.
Unless you want to do it, Al.
No, I don't want to do it. I just want to.
I mean, I think that's what I do, man.
We do need to notify our client.
Yes, and certify mail.
I hope up the $25 pays for that.
Yeah, that's the thing, I spend that $25 on mail.
Yeah.
Do you, Julie, do you understand the motion and the amended motion? Does that, did you get that? Just making sure.
Well, yeah, okay. First, Michael made a motion to extend the order of conditions 1 month to May 25th. Yeah, and then Al seconded that. And then Jimmy made a friendly amendment that in addition to that extension, the board's going to ask him to come to the next meeting, explain the delays, and establish a plan to move forward.
Yeah.
Okay, so we voted on that. That was 5-2.
Okay.
Any emergency permits? No. Bills? No. Minutes for approval. Anika, I know you made some electronic changes. Did you?
I didn't. I only saw one Mr. Lynch.
Oh.
That's okay. That's
I didn't look at the minutes from last time because I wasn't here. But I did notice in the previous minutes, we're calling this the board, and it's not the board, it's the commission. We should be identified as the commission.
I want to be a board because
tree policy working group.
Please put big in quotes.
Update.
Are we going to build in the minute?
Oh, yeah. Any changes from anybody else?
I'm going to go and redo this so we don't have any problems tomorrow.
Okay.
So you guys are just talking about minutes.
I actually have one thing I need to talk to you about.
I'm going to come back.
Right. I move we approve the minutes as amended.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Trees, shrubs, ground cover.
We have not met yet for the tree policy working group. First meeting is tomorrow in this room, 9 to 9:45. Whoever, can I just have a show of hands who's gonna be here in person and who's we need to call in? Who's gonna arrive by phone? So first of all, who's arriving in person? So Al, it's gonna be you and me. And by phone?
I don't know.
Okay. If can you
how do I do this?
Can you just call?
I have your phone number. Can I just call you?
You have my cell? Yeah, just call me before 9.
Okay. All right.
And if I don't hear from you, we'll just won't call you.
Tomorrow's Thursday. I have something in the morning, but I don't know what. So I don't have my schedule with me.
Yeah. Okay.
I misspoke. I'm out June 8th. I'm here next time.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
I don't think I'm not going to be there on the
11th. Anybody else not going to be able to make it next? What?
I don't know.
You don't know yet?
I can't think for sure.
Okay. Amy, what about you?
I'll be here.
Okay, great.
Yeah, I should be here.
Yep.
Should be here. Yeah.
Yep.
I think that there's a June 22nd meeting, and I know I won't be able to attend.
Yeah, I'll be at the 11th. The next meeting. Oh, you know what? did we have to act on Main Street?
We got that, but we never did site visits.
I drove
for
tired at 45 miles an hour today.
What on Main Street?
There's a little house development just north of the playhouse.
It's right next to the old firehouse. The old fire hose house on Main Street.
Near North Reading. So it's...
It's the Dandelions.
Oh, no. Remember North, it's the guy next to the lady who has that... she was... If they blast, it'll...
Oh, yeah.
Descriptions
yeah.
like that are so
dandelions?
No, it's that one next to the thing with the woman.
What it is
with the tree?
The tree lady.
Yeah,
yeah, the tree lady.
He, Chuck can't hold up a building occupancy permit. And the only thing that it's held up with this is that the seed, the grass seed, hasn't taken. And they're looking for a certificate of compliance. And it's, the seed hasn't taken because it's still too early.
We have before.
No. No, you can't. That's
is the grass now in? Or are you saying it's still not?
No, it's too early. I, you know, if
we
you
have,
would, they hydroseeded it,
but it's kind of
but it's
gone
still
out of practice.
It's on a really steep slope.
Holding up the occupancy.
Yeah, it's kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Well, I know which one.
It hadn't been sold, I don't think, last time we drove by.
I think
it
has.
It has.
I think it has.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know where it's on
this
Main Street,
like
just south of Dandelions.
First meeting,
it's going up the hill on the same side of the street as Dandelions.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
a little house
here.
Tucked
right.
in.
Right.
I think I might have even just attended
oh.
the meeting.
You know what I'm talking
wasn't
about?
Part of the commission.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
That's the one. What is that? 40 in the 35? Somebody do a site visit?
They had to take it out. They had to revise the plans. This was, I think, before I was on the commission, but I was at the meeting.
Talking about Main Street.
Well, because I was trying to join.
Oh, I'm thinking about the wrong one.
1261.
One where they were going to bring the water main.
This
so what's happening at 1261? Nothing?
Well, we
what,
have
no.
Have
this is the one that was like a 5 foot drop off of Main Street, the property.
That you can't hold up an occupancy.
It didn't even seem like it was a lot that you
yeah.
could.
Did you guys explain it?
Yeah.
I thought
and
I did.
They just, yeah, I know.
Do you know what we're talking about?
Jack was the engineer.
Yes. So I was saying that Chuck can't hold up an occupancy permit. And the only thing that hasn't been done is the seed from the hydroseeding hasn't taken.
Right, he's not ready. So I have Form 8A, and I have the letter from Jack, and I have an as-built plan, it's not ready to go yet. So, and I asked him to contact the owner and let them know that he doesn't have a certificate of compliance. The owner has contacted me and, you know, haven't had a phone conversation yet, but we will. And I guess in another month and a half, it'll be on this site visit list to go over there and check and see what's going on.
So what's he asking for now?
This is 1261 Main Street. They're just asking for a certificate of compliance, and it was too early for this commission to issue it, but I tried to use that opportunity where they wanted their occupancy to get my Forms 8A, the registered letter from the engineer, and my as-built plan to have those in my pocket, so we only had to wait for the homeowner to contact us and tell us the grass has been established and we can go out there and take a site visit. They're not asking for anything else.
So they're not asking for a certificate of compliance?
No, they understand that they're in a waiting period for that, for the grass to grow.
So they can transfer title subject to that?
I haven't heard anything about that. So.
And Chuck, I gave you my figure, my marked up figure for that project.
Chuck, did you
Kay.
See in this as-built, it said 40 in the facts, it looks like it's on the as-built, it looks like it's in the 35.
I see that.
Yeah.
Really?
They put it on the wrong side of the porch. They didn't put it on the proposed side.
Oh, so that's what you said.
Oh, did you take
I
back your...
I marked it up, and I gave you the...
Right, well, I have those right here. If anyone wants to see Anika's hard work...
I have.
Can I
we
that?
Can get into it later if you want to move on to something else.
Yeah, this has been.
What's
that's
this last thing we got in
want,
here?
That's fine. I need this signed, so no one leave until this gets signed.
So who are we signing this for?
This is 30 Gavin Circle. That was. I just wanted to make sure there wasn't going to be any issues, so I typed in that we're giving a partial for 30 Gavin Circle instead of handwriting it.
I had a simple thing. Can I bring it up?
Yeah, sure.
Copies of check. Is this material published anywhere besides the paper copies that are here? Like, is it on the web or anything? The reason I'm asking is when you get people's bank account information, it's a giant fraud problem.
Yeah, you can't trust those bankers.
You can't.
Mm.
I spend my days fixing these when these things happen. So the account number gets out there. People pay money for these account numbers, and they use them to commit fraud. So can we not provide copies of the checks, or
can we black out the
well,
the
why
routing
do we need
in
them? Why do we get copies of the checks?
I think we need to show that they've
it's
the proof of
checks,
the paid.
With that is part of the regular permit review is has the fee been paid. So Chuck can just do
you guys realize that that's not my form. That came to me that way. So that's,
so the applicants
are doing this.
Yeah.
Oh, does it say somewhere in some instructions to provide copies of the checks?
Yes.
I think so, yeah.
It might be.
Yeah,
I
mean,
yeah.
Checklist,
so maybe
it
they wouldn't be doing it.
So maybe when you get it, if you just leave the checks off.
Do they give you copies of the checks, or do they give you the check?
We get the checks and copies, and I'm not sure it says it in the form, but it may.
I think it does.
I think it might as proof of payment.
It's just really not a good thing to have people's bank account information floating around all over the place. That's all.
Especially, you know, if they do get hacked, would they be able to trace it back to us?
No.
No.
When they submit something for public record.
Yeah, they're submitting it. But
I mean,
what happens is there are a million different ways to tap into somebody's bank account. You don't want a dissertation at 10:30 on a Wednesday night, but you know, we spend so much time undoing and actually checking people who want to do business with us. And we say no all the time to people who want to set up banking service, commercial banking services. We say no, we're not doing that.
Why though? Why?
Because it's too easy for them to steal money. And there's a million different ways to do it. Or to launder money.
Okay.
Really bizarre stuff. So anyway, I think it's better just to minimize the amount of copies of
are
this.
Are we all done?
Can I just mention two things?
Yeah.
Okay, one thing. How's that? Chuck, no more updates from New England Power Company about the crazy cedar swamp plans? Nothing.
They think we're going to fold. My honest opinion is they're just saying, this is so old, why are you holding it up to get some more information on it? So I told them I'll look in the archives again to find that file and to try to figure out what we were actually allowing. I think that they should put some time into at least putting together a narrative about what the project is. And, you know, he wasn't biting.
Are they looking to do something new or just...
No, the project was the construction of the transmission.
Seems like it.
That's no, I
so
read
why,
it, and
so
that's exactly
they,
what it was,
they're
and how
for a
they were
of compliance.
Why?
Because
they probably want to sell the asset to somebody.
Oh.
So they need to clear
okay.
it, and that's the reason I would think that they would do it, and it was, you know, here's how we cut it. Here's what we allow got allowed to do. They got allowed to throw the. Wood into the wetlands and let it decompose, and I'm like, oh wow, reading this one. I said that wouldn't happen today, but that's basically what it was.
Right.
And those three plans probably show the location of the structures.
Well, from a practical standpoint, should we go take a walk and go look at it?
Yeah.
I say no.
It's
because we have
it's in the
no
middle of
plans. So we have no map.
We don't know what we're looking at.
Yeah,
we
okay.
have no. There's no property lines out there. We don't know when we're in
don't
north
yeah.
unless you come out with your
us.
GPS.
Yeah.
But
same
then,
no, you're right.
Really,
you're right. The same as the other
no.
one.
No.
So
Chuck, I don't know why we can't.
Why.
I mean, what are the plans gonna tell you?
Because we don't know what we're issuing. We don't know what we're certifying. We haven't actually done the.
You certify the actual transmission line that's out there and how it was constructed. And it was constructed in what? what was it?
Yeah.
Oh, 77.
77?
But I think
you're not going to see anything where they cut it and where they, because it's all done. I mean, and they maintain it.
But I'm sure they have schematics, drawings of their utility easement.
Should.
With plots of their poles.
Yeah.
And a line of Reading versus North Reading on it. That's kind of all really we need.
Right, because to Mike's point, I mean, how do
to
we know
walk
that
the, our
it
property
wasn't 5 feet
that
from
they
the North
accessed.
Reading property line and they moved it?
What?
So.
It's not even under
jurisdiction.
Hey.
Hey, one conversation, guys.
So.
I wasn't even yelling, man. I have four kids. All right,
what's
man.
The second,
second
thing?
One.
Let's go.
No, that's it.
Okay. Meeting adjourned.
See you tomorrow. See you
I told my wife this was going to be an easy meeting.
I know. It doesn't make any sense that we have these.
Look short. Poor Ms. Lusk came in with the mysterious lot A. So we don't own lot A.
No, we don't.
So who's going to follow that up, Jamie? Lot A?
Jamie is not going to follow that up.
I don't think we can follow it up.
We can follow it up. You could do a property ownership history of that lot.
Yeah.
And see if the town ever owned it. It's what, a little visit to the assessor's office?
It would only be one, one before.
Yeah.
Were
you really born in 1985?
I was.
Oh, the same age as my oldest. Who I just found out is expecting my first.
Oh,
congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I'm excited. My youngest child.
Hey, Chuck. Did those track
changes
come through on the minutes?
Abby, Robin.